All right, guys, welcome back to the Hearthstone Team Story Playoffs. Let me just get situated for just a second here, as we get Lorinda into this call. 1 second. So it's going to be me, Lorinda, and Shrink hosting this for you. I am D2, by the way. I don't know if I mentioned that. And just give me 1 second right here. So it is going to be Yolo Miracle, who earned their way into the second seed by getting the second best record throughout the regular season. And they are going to be going against your winner of the round of four. And that, of course, was EDG earlier on today. So, yeah, just 1 second while I get my co-casters into the Skype call. Shrink, are you there?
Yes, I am.
All right, we're just trying to get Lorinda into this call at the moment. And I guess while we're waiting for Lorinda to get into this call right here, we're just going to have the interview for you. And looks like it's going to be Fualver first. And I actually casted Fualver earlier today, so he's going to be pretty tired as well. I know that I'm a bit fatigued from having casted five best of fives earlier today as part of the Gold Series. So we'll see how Fualver is able to perform today. But yeah, let's just get to the interviews. And what are they saying, Shrink?
那看了他们之前的比赛，对他们有所了解吗？Yeah, Fualver said yeah. I played a lot today and I still got three classes, but no problem, I got it. And we have Robin here now. Say we lost to Yolo Miracle last time, and we are here for revenge. Three Simon says the format is really exciting, it's really good, and I hope that I don't have to play today.
That kind of gives away who you're starting with, but I suppose maybe they've already submitted that.
And we are really well prepared. Actually, Love CX is not playing. It's really surprising,
dude. Right. I mean, he did play earlier today, and he maybe has been busy, kind of with his own stuff. He is also is 20 years old, so might be busy with school things. You never know. But it looks like we have Rosicky in his stead.
He actually said like Fualver was kind of playing too badly, so he went to the last match of the Gold Series, so they didn't have that much time that they hoped to prepare. But doesn't really matter. They're going to win.
So, yeah, it looks like we are going to go to a break. I'll talk a little bit about the gold series that I casted earlier today. That's Fu Oliver, that you saw on the screen earlier, or just now, will be, you know, he was part of that as well. So we'll go over that later. But in the meantime, we're going to go to a break, so stick around. We will have your semifinal match coming up soon.
We are hope.
We are honor.
We are courage.
We are justice.
We are compassion.
We are determination.
Nobody knows about the kind of shit that go wild, we don't sense. Nobody cares about the kind of shit that go power you crash less. Nobody knows about the kind of shit that's electronic food to go mess. Nobody cares about the kind of shit that could show you less.
Alright guys, welcome back to the Hearthstone Team Story. I am D2 and with me is Lorinda and Shrink3. Thank you so much to Callum for being able to host the first round of this playoffs, which was between EDG and Tongfu. And if you missed that, it was a really nice series and EDG was able to come out on top. I believe it was 9-6. Best of 17, these all are basically last hero standing, so it's an insane situation right now. And yeah, Lorinda, are you with us?
I'm with you, yeah.
Him. All right. Sorry?
Cool. So not only is it last hero standing, but it's last player standing. It's normal last hero standing rules.
Is there any way to turn up your microphone just a little bit?
Sure, hold on. How's that?
Still a little bit quiet. Might be an issue with Skype. I'm not really sure.
How about that now?
That's a lot better. Anyway, so we do have our classes on the screen here. Starting from the top left, it's going to be Robin, Sleepy Shaman, Rosicky, and Fu Oliver actually playing the three decks. for Yolo Miracle there, and going to be No Tomorrow going with the three decks for EDG once more. So we'll have to keep an eye on that and what they go for in the future. Looks like Shrink. I believe that my voice is maybe echoing on your computer. So yeah, it's getting a lot of feedback.
I don't think so. I muted all the things.
Well. At least on Skype, what it's showing is that whenever I hear the feedback, your portrait lights up, but not now, so hopefully it continues to be that way. In any case, we have our win percentages on the screen there for both of our teams. Obviously, Yolo Miracle was able to barely edge out EDG over the regular season. That's what earned them the first round bye to get them to the spot in the tournament without having to win, you know, a series like EDG has already had to do. So that will give them also an advantage, potentially, in what they've seen in the first round as far as the decks that were used. And I'm still getting feedback from you, Shrink.
I think I'm restarting my computer, and yeah.
All right. Thank you. Sorry to everyone about that. And
can you just check it isn't me before Shrink goes and does everything?
Right. Yeah.
That sounds okay now.
Yeah, it definitely sounds okay right now.
Okay. So sorry about that, guys. Yeah, so this format is not just last... is that loud enough, by the way? Let's get this sorted.
Yeah, it's a bit better now, yeah.
It's not just last hero standing, but it's also last player standing. So when a player... It's normal last hero standing rules, except the player cannot leave until his two or three decks are used. And that's really important. It means that not only have you got to build your nine decks, one of each class, to go against what you think the meta is going to be, but you've got to pair them up accordingly to how you think your players are going to end up as well. And it's... never been done before, so it's going to be really interesting to see how these guys develop to this.
Yeah, this is definitely super interesting. Especially, I mean, we saw in the last round, basically, the strategy to go with, I think it was it Bingxuan, who had both, or was it Yinian? The player who had the aggro shaman plus the control priest there.
Yeah, that was Yinian.
And just, yeah, and having just completely polar opposite decks can help you so much, because if you're able to counter one class, then all of a sudden, if you can win with the other class, then you can basically, you know, all kill the rest of that particular person's lineup, or at least what they're bringing to that day. So that could be a really, you know, awesome way, because it's kind of hard to counter complete polar opposites. It's kind of hard to, you know, bring someone in to counter one deck, and then, you know, maybe you get completely countered going back the other way. So we'll see how, you know, what kind of strategies they come up with here, as we do have Bingxuan coming up here for EDG. And who was our player on the left? I was getting lost in my own thoughts.
I think it was Rosicky, but I wasn't entirely sure.
I think that's probably why I didn't. I didn't actually catch in my mind there, because basically I've already casted for Oliver today. It was the Gold Series on my channel. Basically, we didn't know if these two shows were going to overlap. And Full Over has actually already played today. He played in a completely different studio and came to the studio, or went to the studio that the Team Story is at. And he actually went to the Decider match. And I guess that's all I'm going to spoil for you. You guys can go over to my YouTube or maybe my Twitch to go watch that if you don't want to get spoiled. But I'll spoil that the fact that Sleepy Shaman was able to advance out of his group yesterday. So Yolo Miracle doing really well. As far as individually is concerned, and hopefully they're able to ride that success in this team event as well and get to the finals to face off against Team Celestial, who did so well over the regular season. By the way, just to put faces to names, I know you guys don't really know all the Chinese players. On the left there is Robin, to his right are Fualver, to the guy to his right in the glasses was Sleepy Shaman. And on the screen we have Rosicky on the left and Bingxuan on the right. So remember these guys, they will be part of a lot of tournaments going forward. And who knows, maybe they'll be part of tournaments in the Western scene as well. We tend to have, you know, China versus X a lot of times. So good to know these players going in and not just, you know, faceless Chinese people when when we have those tournaments go on.
And of course later on we do have No Tomorrow, who was in the Western scene not that long ago at BlizzCon. So he'll make an appearance later. And we don't know the deck, so we're catching up as you guys do. And Bingxuan's got... these are the decks, so he'll have Mage and Paladin against Hunter and Priest as starters here.
All right. And was that Shrink loading up Skype there? Was that... we're just totally off.
I'm still here, so...
All right, cool. And just heard a really loud Skype sound. In any case... Going into this game, it's going to be looking like Mech Mage versus Face Hunter. Well, most likely Face Hunter. Sometimes you run Glazuka, sometimes you run Explosive Trap in midrange, but most likely going to be that Face Hunter. And this is just basically about controlling the early game. If either player can secure the early game for the Face Hunter, if they can do so, then they can, you know, basically leverage that into more damage to Face. And Shrink, unfortunately, it's continuing to echo. I'm sorry. Maybe fix something. Yes, it is continuing to echo, unfortunately. Yeah, maybe try to fix some settings, and we'll come back when we are able to, or when you're, maybe the settings are fixed, or we go to a translation or something like that. But in any case, yeah, the Face Hunter basically just wants to get the early game so that they can deal damage, and then the Mech Mage wants to get the early game so that they don't take too much damage, and they can, you know, leverage that into sort of more of a board victory.
Yeah, and interesting to see here that they have been allowed to, EDG have been allowed to completely change their lineup. Not only early did Bing Zhuang not play Paladin, which it looks like he has today, but also they were playing Freeze Mage, not Mech Mage. So they have completely changed their decks for this. So that'll be interesting going forward.
Right, and presumably they, you know, at the very least had some decks set up for themselves before this tournament started. Maybe they even had, you know, the complete set of decks for going forward. And, you know, it's pretty interesting to see how they went with the adjustments, in particular to go against Yolo Miracle. But right now, kind of, Bingxuan's in a kind of awkward position here. It never feels good to trade, you know, a 3-2 into a 2-1, even if they are both 1-drops. But gonna be just doing this to mitigate the damage to the Face. And to his credit, he's still at 26 health.
Yeah, still at 26 health, and like you say, even though it's a 3-2 into a 2-1, it is only that 1-drop buffed by the mechs, and so it's not actually a loss. Like you say, it just feels like you're losing out there, but, you know, having a decent hand here as well, he's got the Nullifier will turn out to be pretty handy against Face Hunter, and having some semblance of boards also a way to keep it together as well. Put on some pressure and put up some defense at the same time.
Right, Arcane Nullifier obviously doesn't, you can't really target with spells. You can target it with silence though, so there is that. But yeah, it looks like Rosicky's going to go with a play that basically gives away that he has Explosive Trap, but, you know, nonetheless, there's not a whole lot that Bingxuan can do here as far as countering this Explosive Trap. Either you sit there and you don't attack, or you attack and all your minions die, and both of which are kind of painful in this situation.
Kind of interesting that he's choosing to portal there when he had two mechs that he could play whilst the mech warp was still reduced cost. And
well, the problem is that if he did go ahead and play both of those, then they would both take two damage. So you're basically looking at a 2-3 taunt and a 2-1 snow chugger, which is still pretty strong, granted. But it's just
He's in no hurry. He's got under no life pressure, so he can afford to sit and wait, I guess. And as he wasn't intending to attack that turn, then just sitting and waiting is fine. I can see that. It's just interesting that he chose not to save the two mana. But this is one thing that people learning Hearthstone don't tend to do against Hunters. Just say, well, you've got a trap, but I'm under no pressure. You've got to play something or you're not going to be able to kill me.
I mean, one thing to keep in mind as well is Bingxuan played for a long time earlier today. And, I mean, us as casters, we definitely know that it's pretty hard to do anything when you're fatigued. And just earlier today, as we see the Mech Warper actually getting traded off here, just earlier today, there was a match, or basically we had the other player that went to the Decider match in the Gold Series was a player by the name of Xingsu, who was on Invictus Gaming. And he was absolutely spent by the end, and basically just, you know, playing out stuff, like, I hope this Knife Juggler hits, and you could see it on his face. It was absolutely insane. So hopefully that doesn't, you know, weigh too hard on the players here, but that could be a factor here.
Yeah, it's really hard to describe that feeling when you've streamed or cast or played for several hours. There comes a point where you just can't think anymore. It's really ridiculous. Oh, why don't you put in one little spurt of effort, but there comes a point where you just can't do it. It's different for different people, but when you're there, you can't do it, and oh my goodness.
Always Leok.
Always Leok, just when you don't want it.
Never have for baby rage. Anyway, so yeah, it looks like, you know, Bingchuan is kind of taking the lead here in this particular situation. I mean, he has more burst than, you know, the face hunter here, which isn't too surprising, to be completely fair. But by this point, you know, if the hunter had, you know, this little burst in hand, then you'd expect that it was already spent and Bingchuan would be at 10 health right now, but that's not the case at all.
So he knows there's a really good chance of hitting one of those twice if he plays the Blast Mage. So he had to weigh up there whether he wanted to play the Blast Mage and have the outside chance of one of them not taking two, or whether he just wants to play the safe Fireball, which is a slightly more, like, less developmental card, but obviously far more safe. And he just went for the safe route. He sees no reason to gamble in this position.
So look at Rosicky's posture here, and I'm pretty sure Bingchuan can see him based on how the studio is laid out. So that's a dead giveaway that you have a really bad hand and nothing's going right for you. And if I were a player here, I mean, and Rosicky shouldn't really. Did I call him something else, by the way?
No, you didn't. You got it right.
Okay, sorry. I'm getting a tired bit myself here, but Rosicky, it's not like he shouldn't really be tired, right? So there's no reason for him to be like this frustrated and this emotional, I don't think. And
yeah, especially when it's game one, best of 17. It's like, exactly, you've done nothing wrong. It's not like you've made a critical error. You've just drawn badly. You've not let your team down by losing when you draw like this and your opponent's had a good draw. He's just too emotionally invested, which obviously, when there's a lot of money online, you're emotionally invested, but the key is to not let it get to you until you've crossed the line one way or the other.
Yeah, exactly. It just basically gives your opponent kind of a leg up, kind of a one-up, you know, realizing, okay, I got this, you know, my opponent just kind of devastated, I can get this game, maybe I can get into his head as well. And you might not think it matters, but it definitely does. You know, even just knowing like what your opponent can possibly have, but
again, especially saying what you've just said, Bingchuan's already played today. He is going to be tired to some degree. If he sees that, it maybe just gives him that little bit more energy to go, okay, one more time. Let's get this one more time. We've got this. And yeah, Rosicky not happy at all here. He's really struggling with the nerves. He's trying to relax himself as well, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And it looks like he's just going to go for kind of a YOLO turn here with the Knife Juggler. One hits face, not what he wants at all, obviously. And the next one hits the Arcane. Oh, that's actually, those next two were pretty perfect. But, I mean, this quick shot, where can you possibly aim it?
Another quick shot?
It would have to be another quick shot. Unfortunately, picks up an Arcane Golem, which he can't even play. That's going to be game one going over to EDG and Bingchuan, clearing out their mage right away.
Yeah, and that's really important, I think. You get to keep the mage. It's last year of standing today.
Oh, right. I've been casting Conquest for
no,
so long.
No, that's fine. You cast so many different formats in the space of 24 hours.
I'm sorry. I've been casting Best of 5 Conquest with one ban today, and then, you know, so just things all over the place. So I'm sorry.
So interesting that the Yolo Miracle strategy is the same that EDG did themselves earlier, actually, that Tung Fu did earlier, actually, is you've got a class that isn't regarded as very good, so get it out of the way first. If it loses, you're sort of only half a zero to behind rather than 1-0 behind, in a way. Because you've lost a class that's expecting to lose anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good way to play Last Hero Standing, in my opinion. Get something out of those. When it's best of 17, like, who knows what's best, but get something out of the way that you're expecting to lose anyway.
Apparently that wasn't explained to Rosicky, because he is not happy sitting there. He just continues to tilt and just be upset here. Just every single thing that comes on the board continues to shake his head. And, I mean, just from the beginning here, his mentality, I don't think it's been too great.
I'm wondering if they saw that this was a mage and just assumed everyone plays freeze mage. I think he may have caught them out by switching here.
Right.
So Rosicky's got to this seat expecting a freeze mage match against Hunter, which you'd have thought, whichever side of that are, you fancy your chances, wherever you're sat. And I get the impression that maybe he's just sat here and gone, it's not fair, it's not my day, why does this guy switch on me, why do I get the mech mage sort of attitude.
Right.
That could definitely be the case. We've all been in that mood.
Alright, well, this this Deathlord is going to do a lot of work, going to soak up 9 damage here, and it's going to be up to Bingchuan. Just going to see what he gets here. He gets a Spider Tank, which is pretty good. In particular, there's no battle cry on that guy, so it's a nice, you know, fat minion that, you know, he just gets on the board and puts more pressure onto his opponent. A Circle of Healing would be great. Nope, doesn't get it. It's going to be a North Shore Cleric, and Rosicky's just going to have to look inside and decide what to do here. But on the side of Vingshan, did play with that pile of Shredder. Could have gone for the Gorilla there, but decided that, you know, he can draw cards later. For now, just put a nice, you know, resilient minion on the board.
Another thing that's interesting, just going back to Rozuki's attitude again, when it's Conquest, I can understand this to some degree. Because you sit there and you think, I'm going to be here for hours.
Right.
I'm going to just keep losing. How the hell do I get out of this? But this is last year of standing. If he loses two games, he's out anyway. So how hard is it to pump yourself up for two games?
Yeah, exactly. Just battle it out and just, you know, go down fighting and do all that you can to do. But
Gorilla comes out. Yeah, you're playing good team as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
But what do you go for here? Do you just go for the Fellreaver and just, you know, smork it up? I mean,
I keep it back and make him get rid of this lot and then just plop it down the second as my comeback play.
Right. The Mecha Torque is kind of just too late game. And the other one was a Suit Spear. It was just too small, to be frank. It's like, well...
Yeah, he's got enough small things already. So.
Yeah, exactly. But
I don't think we'll see the Fellreaver next turn. We might, actually. But everything dies. Well, we might not. We might see it because there's a 3-4 and a 1-3, so not everything does die to Light Bomb.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would just play it because if
I think you just smoke it down.
Yeah, if he doesn't have Light Bomb, then you win the game, right? Because you, if even if you Shadow Word Death, then your other guys get to attack, and even if he does use Light Bomb, he uses the entire turn, and then you're getting an extra 4 damage in the following turn. So I think it's perfectly fine to just play it out.
Yeah, and Shredder as well. You're actually fine to just put it on the table, depending exactly what happens here, but.
Then, you
obviously, you've got the decisions to make using the Okanoi and the Flash Heal here, but when someone's smoking you down and you've got Okanoi on the table, you lose the ability to heal ever again. That's obviously a concern.
Yeah, so it looks like he's going to go for a bit of a different play. And to be fair, this actually gets the same amount of damage off the field by utilizing this Pyromancer here. And I'm going to heal up the Pyromancer. I do like the play of, you know, preserving the Pyromancer. It prevents, you know, simple ping from killing it. And this actually puts a lot of pressure on Bing Chun, honestly. You know, if
bit
he runs...
decision here.
Sorry?
Because of the portal allowing to buff the Mana Worm. So now that top deck may well stop him from playing the Reaver.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, if you go for the Reaver, you kind of have to trade into the Pyromancer because you don't know what could possibly be coming on your opponent. Tundra Rhino comes out for Bing Chun. That's a charger. That guy can smirk, but it'll be interesting to see what he goes for here. I mean, if he does trade with the Pyromancer with a Tundra Rhino, that's completely vulnerable to Light Bomb. So
and might... Holy Nova as well actually comes into play to a large degree there as well if he does it that way. So I think he may still choose to trade in a Mana Worm anyway.
Right.
And the fact he's thinking of buffing up the Rhino seems to imply that he will just put the Mana Worm into the...
The fact that he bought the Rhino, I mean, he does get extra damage on the Mana Worm. Maybe it would have been better to just trade in that Monkey there. But,
Yeah, because it'd be... I think he's just playing around Nova. He doesn't want to get too many things Nova'd at once. Light Bomb's a lot more resource-heavy and actually doesn't do much here.
Right.
Leaves with a 3-2 Rhino and a 2-drop, which is fine.
What do you think about Bing Chuan constantly trading here, by the way? I mean, obviously, that last turn, you kind of get a bit, you know... torn up if you don't take out the Pyromancer, but there's a lot of things on this board. I mean, like for instance, the Northshire Cleric earlier that was, you know, a bit costly to take care of. Just a lot of trading here from Bing Chuan. What do you think about him just kind of being trade heavy, not going face?
I think he's okay. I think that he's clearing the way. Like, Pyromancer's an actual dangerous minion. Northshire's a dangerous minion. I think it's okay to keep this clear. He's getting enough damage there. It's not like he's trading into nothing. He's trading and still hitting for huge chunks. Like, he's going to trade here. Well, he's going to fireball here and hit for 9.
Right. I think he's going to hit the face first to see, like, wait, how much damage is this? Let me just...
Yeah, add it up. I can't be bothered to add it up. I've been doing this a long time.
One damage up lethal. And actually...
And he can't heal.
Yeah, actually, if you just ping the face, or, I mean, just play the Fellreaver, one of the two, maybe just fireball face and ping face. I mean...
Yeah, that's better. I think. I don't think you fireball and ping face.
But how does your opponent possibly... I mean,
he would have to circle,
trade off his Akanai into the 3-5.
And then heal phase.
Then heal phase, and then,
three then.
Then he has remaining 5 mana to do something, but he's still... Yeah, so this could backfire, but in a lot of cases, it works out fine. And yeah, exactly.
And he shoots himself to death, which is what he's been trying to do since he's first sat down.
Exactly.
So he'll go home happy.
So Rozuki tilts his way to a couple losses, and Bing Chuan is 2-0 for his team EDG. Yolo Miracle... receiving the second seed coming into this, receiving that first round by, is now finding itself down 0-2 in this best of 17. Sounds like such a long series. I mean, it admittedly is a very long, you know, situation, But, I mean, 2 out of 9 already down for them.
Yeah, and they're not impressed with that. Like, don't sit with us, go somewhere else.
Yeah, look at Fualver, look at Sleepy Shaman, they're just giving him...
We don't want you to sit here.
Yeah, just go somewhere else, what were you
go
doing?
Go sit with them, you're just giving them 2 games. Right. So, yeah, I don't know, that's inexplicable to me. Especially in a team game, if you want to ruin your own game by tilting and crying and stuff, then fine.
I mean, to be fair, there was nothing really he could have done. There was he would have lost those 2 games no matter what, pretty much. But just his body language is just really, you know, kind of ruining it for Yolo Miracle. And the crazy thing is you know, he should feel privileged, honestly, to be able to play for them today. Because if Love was available, if Love CX, you know, was able to play this, he would be here today. He would Rosicky would not be playing. It would be Robin, Sleepy Shaman, Fualver, and Love. And that's a dominant, like, devastating team. And looks like we are going to be having Sleepy Shaman come
and
out.
And he actually isn't sat with them, I don't think, when he flicked back there, by the way. You know me, looking for the gossip. there was the management bits and pieces behind like there were before, but I didn't actually see him sat there. I think they might have sent him into the crowd.
Obviously that would be really
different,
funny.
Different competitor now, though, with Sleepy Shaman.
Yeah, Sleepy Shaman is on a completely other level. 22-16. He actually was in contention for a bit there for the MVP, obviously on the number 2 team in the league. And I think he had one of the best records, if not the best record, on their team. Looks like he's looking for a drink here. But he did get out of his group yesterday using Murloc Paladin. And so that was pretty exciting to cast.
Wow, yeah, I was predicting earlier, actually. I thought Murloc Paladin would be a deck in this because it counters Control Warrior completely. And so in Last Hero Standing, having a deck that just completely counters one of the other decks can be a thing, especially as the deck's playable anyway.
Yeah, and the format that we had, obviously, I mean, I mentioned a bit before, it was Conquest with a ban, and that's kind of cool to bring Murloc Paladin. It was actually brought yesterday and today. By Fualver, actually, his teammate. So both of them played Murloc Paladin.
So we could see that today, yeah.
Right. And so the interesting thing is that Murloc Paladin, the reason why it's not tier 1 or even like tier 2 is that just too many of the good decks counter it. But if you get rid of just one of those decks, all of a sudden, how many decks can beat it, right? It's maybe 1 or 2. And so you're almost certainly going to get a win, especially in the Conquest format with a Ben.
Sleepy's
so.
Got Rogue and Warlock.
Right. Okay, so Sleepy Shaman here. Not playing Shaman. That's been kind of a trend lately, that Sleepy Shaman has not been playing Shaman. And it gets confusing, especially with his name. But yeah, like you said, going to be Rogue, going to be Warlock. It'll be interesting to see what Warlock it is. I'm getting actually a bit confused in my head because there's been so many games. He actually beat Malilock twice with Freeze Mage yesterday. So in my head, I think he's playing Malilock, but I don't know. That's completely
who knows.
Obviously.
Yeah, it's all blurring into one huge Hearthstone festival.
Exactly.
Notice there again, I'm just going to mention it one more time, and I will let it go. But Sleepy, the exact opposite body language, gets his water, takes a sip, puts it on the floor, projects that he's going to be there for a few hours. You've got to shift me out of the way. Instantly, just that exact opposite image. So this matchup. He would have chosen. They could choose what they wanted here, so they must like the matchup. That's how Last Hero Standing works. What's the next major chances? Is their best chance to draw Snow Chugger and just keep the Rogue frozen? Or
their best chance is to hope that Rogue doesn't draw Blade Flurry, to be honest. I mean, this works out pretty well here. I mean, that Noichon is pretty annoying, obviously, by its name, but this backset plus fan that you just picked up is really nice. That's a really nice pickup there.
What do you make of Harrison in this Rogue deck?
The Harrison, basically, I mean, you're playing, you really need to beat Shaman, obviously it's helpful in a lot of other matchups as well. I mean, there's so many weapon classes right now that are very, very strong, so it definitely makes sense. I imagine he's running one Harrison and one Azurajic, because you typically have to cut an Azurajic to do that, otherwise it's too expensive.
You're sort of treating it as your card draw and having to make do, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
That makes sense to me.
Sleepy Shaman can clear the board here. Let's see if he does go for it. It would involve using prep, however, which is definitely very powerful. Looks like he's not going to go for it, which means he's going to take 4 damage to the face from Mr. Goblin Blast Mage here, who loves fire. It's his absolute favorite.
But now we have Backstab, Blood Mage, and...
Oh, we don't have Backstab.
...Fan as an option.
We don't have Backstab. We do have...
Prep.
Prep, yeah, we have prep. Backstab actually would have been a bit better in this situation because he could have cleared the board, but looks like it's going to be Azurajic just to fill out this, you know, curve here. and they're going to be the prep fan as well. Didn't really need to use the blood mage there, but
interesting. Yeah. After joining the second sprint, he chooses to use the prep because obviously those sprints are going to just stick in his hand, probably for the whole game now, or at least for the whole game that matters.
Right. I mean, the thing about sprint is that a lot of times you actually don't use the prep with it. You want to use the prep for, I mean, different situation. Mm-hmm. If you're playing as an aggro deck, prep sprint is a desperation move.
Yes.
And you really just want to use the prep for just getting tempo back in the field. But, yeah, I mean, Sleepy Shaman has finally taken control of the board, but he's at 12 health, so that's a bit of an issue.
You're into double portal mode, though. Anything can happen in the next few seconds here.
Gilblin is kind of nice because it's kind of like charging to the face in a way. And
With the opponent on this low life total as well, I mean, there's a heal bot, so it's not an imminent, but we don't know that from this side. That Gilblin is definitely a card healer wanted to see.
Backside was kind of nice here. Sleepy Shaman continues to drink water. I remember when I played that if I drink too much water, I have to go to the bathroom really badly, so that kind of makes me concerned for it. But
yeah, I drink the whole time I'm playing. I think it's almost a nervous thing.
Right, but yeah, I was wondering how risky Sleepy Shaman was going to play. It looks like he's playing it very unrisky, but it is kind of preparing for the future, right? As we see a Goblin Mechatoric come to the screen once more. Wait, not Mechatoric. Is that what it's called? I'm getting these cards mixed up. It makes
that is Mechatoric, I think.
Mechatoric. Okay, I'm for some reason I thought I was wrong, but that guy makes Leopard Gnomes. That's all you need to know, and. We do have Tinkers come into the hand of Sleepy Shaman, but yeah, going back to the heal bot, basically what that was, even though it seemed a bit too safe, what it was doing, it was saying that I need to play this eventually, and I don't really have anything much better now, so I might as well play it now so I don't have to use 5 mana in the future.
Yeah, just using his mana correctly, and like you say, it wasn't bad against the stuff on the board, it wasn't great, but might as well do it, because you might not have to play the Harrison if you draw good stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
You are going to have to play that healing bot at some point, so 8 now. The surprise value is kind of minimal with it, so...
Yeah, exactly. We did... You saw a rogue with 2 heal bots earlier today, right? I think I remember that. Yes. Watching the cast. And we've seen a lot more heal bots, you know, kind of in rogue and just in general, just to help players out against a lot of aggro decks. Obviously, Shaman being super strong here. But
I think that's because that in this format, you're forced into playing 3 or 4 aggro decks. Like, you can't not play an aggro Shaman deck.
Mm-hmm.
Mid-range Hunter's still an aggro deck. Let's cause some arguments there, but near enough an aggro deck, and so on. And so you're forced to play at least 2 or 3 aggro decks, and you probably add 1 or 2 to the mix just because they're good, and suddenly you need to stop aggro really, really urgently.
Right.
So that would make sense in this particular format. It doesn't mean you should necessarily go home, stick all healbots in your rogue decks.
Do it, guys. You'll win. but anyway, Sap comes up onto the Mechatoric here, and it's really nice to Sap something that's been Unseeable Portal, because you're kind of taking away the advantage of what they've gotten, right? You're making it cost way more.
You countered the portal.
Yeah, exactly. And this card isn't good if it's not portaled, so that's an issue. But it looks like it's just going to be, you know, second Tinkers here and hitting the face and Blade Flooring, which is a ton of damage coming here for Bingxuan. And he doesn't have any way to really deal with this. He's going to have to pick something up, and if he does pick up something, then that means it's not going face. Picks up the Frostbolt, though. Now he can pair that with Antonidas, and this is actually pretty nice for Bingxuan. I mean, that was the best card in his deck. I mean, Fireball wouldn't have really paired with Antonidas. Now he can go play the Mana Worm as well.
Yeah, and this was interesting because last turn he had the option to play Antonidas, the Mana Worm, and the Clockwork Gnome. And because the Clockwork Gnome makes a spare part, I think he decided that was his tiebreaker in whether to play that or whether to play the Mechatoric. And that's now going to pay off for him because now he's going to get to fill his handful of Fireballs. He can get a Fireball off the Clockwork Gnome next turn if his Antonidas lives as well.
Right. I think part of it was also that there was a 4 attack dagger on the side of Sleepy Shaman, and mm-hmm. all he had to have was Blade Flurry, and even if he takes 5 damage, I think that's way too painful for Bingxuan there to absorb, is, you know, everything getting cleared. But looks like we're going to have yet another Blade Flurry, I presume. I think that was double deadly poison. Sleepy Shaman's playing really fast here. Yeah, so that's double deadly poison, so likely going to just use his King's Elect there onto the Antonidas, and just gonna go ahead and do that, clear everything out. He's 2 damage off lethal, but he still has to kind of trade here, obviously, because, you know, it's too dangerous.
Yeah.
Blingtron 3000 hits the field. And
why wouldn't it?
We haven't seen any water elementals, have we?
I haven't seen a water elemental in this, no, not today.
So the reason why you play Blingtron is because you have double Snow Chugga and double Water Elemental, and you just freeze your opponent's...
your opponent has Harrison. Not that it's going to matter.
Yeah, exactly.
And he won't play it. Like, there won't be a BM where he plays Harrison here, because they won't show the card. Because he will get to play him a game with the same deck, because it's last hero standing, so...
That is absolutely hilarious, though, the fact that he had Harrison and didn't have time to play it until that moment anyway. But yeah, in any case, Sleepy Shaman comes in and basically says, Rosicky, get out of here. Let me show you how it's done. Picks up a win with the Rogue, and it is suddenly 1-2, and we're going to Bingxuan's Paladin. That's mm-hmm. another good matchup for the Rogue, no matter what it is.
Yeah, like one of the absolute best matchups, I think, at the moment, outside of the obvious sort of one-sided nonsense. Rogue Paladin, just the way that the fan and the hero power interact with each other, excuse me, before you even start working on the actual builds, and Rogue has just a natural advantage.
Yeah, definitely.
That's looking like a tidy hand there.
Yeah, I mean, if you're talking about, you know, muster for battle, it's just his natural predator is going to be the fan, right? It's like, yeah. Well... We spent the exact same mana, but I got a life stress and you got a card. I think you win this one. So that's definitely...
Again, playing the Secret Paladin, so they have chosen to go easy on themselves, and not easy on themselves, but they've chosen to play maybe more simple decks. That's slightly easier decks for Bingxuan than this afternoon. Mm-hmm. Possibly to make it a little bit, you know, factoring in the tiredness maybe a little bit. Or maybe just trying to catch the other team off guard and play a load of different decks.
The thing is... Secret Paladin is very polarized as well, and then you can kind of just throw it in and beat a druid, for instance. So it's yeah, it's just one of those things where you can just kind of, you know, defeat a lot of things, and you don't really need the mid-range paladin to be more well-rounded.
Yeah, excuse me again. And this is looking pretty grim for him, though. This hand is...
Yeah, Dr. Boom into Tyrion is good when you're already on turn 7 and have already played the Mysterious Challenger, but in this situation, not so much.
And Sleepy not messing around there, just doing the Eviscerate to save himself.
Yeah, I mean...
6 damage here, that's a lot of damage to save.
Yeah, 6 damage here, and if he had gotten really greedy and used his hero power to take that out, he would have taken a total of 12 damage. So, yeah, I think it's perfectly fine to go for what he did there.
Not necessarily an obvious play, though, to use your Eviscerate so,
right.
So liberally there.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it feels kind of bad as we see the Harrison Jones come into the hand of Sleepy Shaman once more, so that will be pretty nice, particularly in the future. Though Divine Favor could be something to come back in an instance, but it's going to
use... What do you think of Divine Favor in Secret Pally as a personal level?
On a personal level? I like how you put that. But it's... I mean, it's reasonable. It makes the deck a bit more consistent when you're playing against control. Mm-hmm. Obviously, less consistent when you're playing against aggro. But, you know, basically what you're trying to beat a lot of times is that control, right? And or even
the reason I ask is I tend to feel that if you get a good Divine Favor off against control, they've already got the cards to deal with whatever you draw anyway. So I sometimes feel like it's not a wasted card. I understand that drawing a lot of cards against control is a really big deal. Mm-hmm. And you keep the hate coming, but I tend to feel that if you do get a big one off against control, the control has a lot of AoE, or it has a lot of just things to counter your things anyway. So as long as it's already got control of the board.
Yeah, but I mean, turning a matchup that you're about to win, you know, 20% of the time because they have so many cards into something mm-hmm. that you win maybe 40% of the time is pretty valuable, I would say.
No, sure. It just depends what you have to give up to get that, whether you're giving up maybe a keeper or something. As this game rumbles on, and double consecration is this?
Yeah, this is in particular just kind of strange deck building right here. I'm fine with the Divine Favor as long as you play a bit more aggressively, but if you're running mm-hmm. double consecrate, it just kind of seems bizarre to me.
Because you're not going to empty this hand often enough to pull the cards back from the Divine Favor, so it should be, or could be, just something a bit more brutal.
Right. And it's kind of, I mean, it makes sense in a kind of roundabout, not making sense too much way, and the fact that you could, you know, kind of play it like you play Elemental Destruction in Shaman, and
yes.
just kind of, you know, wait it out and use your Consecrates to clear the board and then use your Divine Favor to catch up in card draw. But those two, when you start thinking about it, the Consecrate kind of negates the Divine Favor because you can't actually use the Divine Favor in that instance. So that obviously is a consideration as well. But in any case,
yeah.
it's going to be the Xurdrake into Hero Power. Just going to ping off this Divine Shield so it doesn't get a free trade and hit the face with the Xurdrake.
And the second Consecration is going to... No, he was thinking about trading and changed his mind there, which this is a far better looking play.
Right. I mean, Boombots will do the same thing as Consecrate anyway, right? So don't
yeah.
really need that.
But... Yeah, he just literally pricked his arm and thought, no, let's play Dr. Boom, he's green,
mm-hmm.
it's turn 7, what am I doing?
Yeah,
and...
but this is going to be a pretty big Blade Flurry, going to be a 4 damage backstab and a 5 damage Blade Flurry hitting the face here. So, yeah, goodbye Dr. Boom. Unfortunately, no sap yet, but, I mean, you can obviously sprint into that as well. But let's
Tyrion, not a particularly
wow.
big deal when you have
both,
Palisman in hand.
Both Boombots hit face. That's really, really good for Sleepy Shaman. I mean, Paladin is notorious for not having Burst. Basically, the
yep.
way that Secret Paladin is able to kind of... It feels like they have Burst, right? Because they're able to just kill you so quickly. But basically, the reason why, as we see the sap coming out of the... Right out of that sprint from Sleepy Shaman there. The arrow's going everywhere. He's pointing everything
Sleepy
in the face.
Sleepy doesn't mess around, does he?
Yeah. But the funny... I mean, the thing is, like, they seem like they have so much damage, right? Because you have, like, 10 nines and, you know, boom, Dr. Booms and such just hitting the face so often that ends up just being so much damage in the long run. But right now, just not going to be the case. Bing Chong
yeah,
plays
like
out the Tyrion and Repentance, and that's not Redemption, unfortunately. Second sap in hand already for Sleepy Shaman, so that's
going
to be going
to try to win without Harrisoning here. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
Obviously, Harrison really good in this matchup if it does go long for killing Tyrion's Ashbringer. Which is one of the bits of reach that Paladin does have in this deck.
That's the funny part, right? I mean, Harrison should have just absolutely destroyed this game, but Sleepy Shaman just sips another sip of water and doesn't need the Harrison. Easy peasy, Rosicky. This
Send
is how
the next boy in.
Exactly. He's just telling us here, Rosicky, see, it wasn't that hard, right?
But, you got that, he says. So we haven't got the lineups, I don't believe, but it's Yinian, Nicholas, and No Tomorrow are the players. No Tomorrow did have 3 decks, and there's no reason to think he wouldn't have 3 decks again.
Yeah, it was on the screen for a second there. Obviously, it was a bit too fast to write everything down, but yeah, it was No Tomorrow with the 3 decks there.
I think No Tomorrow has Druid and the Hunter, and I forgot what's this third deck, but I think he has the same 3 decks as last.
So Druid, Hunter, and Warlock he had this morning.
Yeah, No Tomorrow excels at playing aggressive decks, so that would definitely make sense for him to go with that. In any case, let's see, what do we have here? Rosicky, his Hunter is gone, and his Priest is gone. And for EDG, the Paladin and Mage of Bingxuan is gone. They're facing against a Rogue and an unknown Warlock, so what do you think they bring out here?
A Rogue and an unknown Warlock.
I suppose, I mean, their number one concern is beating this Rogue, right? So maybe they just throw out a Warrior and hopefully they can deal with it. But looks like they're going with No Tomorrow, so it looks like they're getting aggressive here.
Yeah, and interesting because they deliberately held No Tomorrow back as long as they could earlier. It wasn't just how it worked out, you can see. Yeah, these two exchange a smile. They've obviously played each other in many events before, so...
Yeah,
but
these...
maybe they want to get rid of Sleepy as well. Maybe it's a case of, look, we'll send out 3 decks, but our best player versus one of your best players with 2 decks, and...
Yeah, you know, it could be the fact that Rogue and Unknown Warlock are so... There's just such a wide variety of kind of the range of... First of all, Warlock could be anything, and then on top
mm-hmm.
of that, you know, Rogue and Warlock, the counters don't really line up too well, so maybe going with 3 decks here is a good way to get rid of Sleepy Shaman.
And there's still the Druid as well, which is obviously... For most people in the world, the Druid is the favourite, I think. I think we make this meme every time where the Rogue players still sort of think they can do it. But in general, I think the consensus is the Druid can beat the Rogue now. Although maybe not so much. I mean, people don't play Aspirant so much anymore, which was one of the cards that was making it interesting. So. Interesting to see what he goes with here.
Yeah, obviously we were unable to kind of see what decks he went with, so we're not completely sure. Obviously, Shrink, thanks for helping us out earlier, but we'll see what he goes with going forward in this game against Sleepy Shaman. And this is a battle of heavyweights, honestly. I mean, obviously, No Tomorrow did go to BlizzCon, but Sleepy Shaman, last year, fourth or top four in the Gold Series Grand Finals, basically the tournament I'm casting right now, but last year's version. And, you know, been performing throughout the HGS as well, so this is going to be
and
really
And results high. Aside, just watching him play, we've seen all the way through the thing that he's just a completely top-quality player. Yeah, they're all good, but you can see the real quality players. He's obviously one, results aside anyway. And we're going to get Face Hunter by the look of this.
Yeah, Face Hunter is pretty good against Rogue. There is the Healbot, though, which makes a huge difference. Without Healbot, Face Hunter is a massive favorite. With the Healbot, it gets a bit more even. With two Healbots, it's very, very Rogue favorite. So we'll see how, you know, Sleepy Shaman has built his deck. One thing that's pretty huge here is that, I mean, obviously they haven't seen the Harrison Jones, which is kind of crazy that he was able to beat, you know, a Mech Mage with Blinktron and a Paladin without even touching the Harrison. I mean, that's pretty crazy. I would
yeah, and he knew to keep it back for these sort of situations as well. He knew he didn't need to. Like, some players are inexperienced and just plop it on the table to show off or something, but no.
Look at this turn.
Wow.
Dagger, Prep, Blade Flurry to get rid of two. I mean, it's two for two, to be fair. But, I mean, I suppose if he didn't do that, he would have taken a lot of damage. And he's kind of, you know, giving up some damage in the future to be able to take care of this. And to be fair, against Face Hunter, Blade Flurry isn't really that good. Everything has one health. He might as well
just
use
Ban. I
guess,
yeah, you kill two things for one now, or kill two things with one toughness later, so.
The only thing he's really missing right now is the prep, obviously, and he's missing out on potentially some damage later, but he would have been taking a lot of damage in the interim, so. Kind of an arguable play, but really interesting to see.
One thing that amazes me as well about these really good players is how fast they can play a deck like Rogue, which is really complicated. They seem to spot these plays because they play them a lot so rapidly. Just to know that prep flurry stuff there was actually a thing you could do.
Right. I mean, well, I think what went through his mind here is that he just thought, you know, looking at my hand, there's no way I can deal with this any time in the future. I don't want to face tank all of this. I'm going to take way too much damage. He probably went, okay, two this turn, four this turn, and then two the next turn, and then two after that. And he's just, like, putting it through his head, like, I'm going to be at 20 health by turn three. So I can never win that game. That's probably what he thought.
I have to deal with these right now.
Yeah.
Where are we at now? 17.
17 in turn 5 is still pretty bad, and he has only one prep left in the deck, so still looking pretty dire here for Sleepy Shaman. He's going to have to...
And this hand is pretty good as well.
Yeah, from No Tomorrow. Lots of bursts, exactly.
Lots of bursts, and the stuff he has is sticky enough to stay there as well. But in his mind, he'll be thinking, how do I beat 25, not how do I beat 17, because of the Healbot that's in the deck.
Mm-hmm. Well, to be fair, there's only, you know, now that the SI7 and the Blood Moon's downloads have been played out, there's only two cards left in the hand, so maybe no tomorrow's thinking, maybe I can get through this game before the Healbot is drawn, which is reasonable, especially if there's only one.
He does also have to check that nothing bad happens to him and he doesn't die on the backswing here. He's a long way in front, but it can soon change. When you just let your opponent build a board, it can soon change, so I assume this is going to be Leopard Gnome to see what it hits. I was just going to burst these.
Mm-hmm. It's, I mean, pretty obvious it's going to hit, or pretty likely it's going to hit at least one.
Yeah.
And Bloodfin Raptor, unfortunately, Rogue can't use that to, you know, get a nice kill command on the face of Rexxar here, but...
Notomo is thinking of killing it so he gets the 2 and 3 from the Leper Gnome here.
Yep.
And
hits the right minion, so Notomo definitely running pretty well right now, especially with his Knife Juggler.
Mm-hmm. That's the subtlety to playing Face Hunter. Everyone thinks it is all just face, and it is largely face, but just there taking down that Raptor when you needed to make sure that you could get rid of something else that was in the way. Rather than just sticking everything in face, just making sure that your guys are there to hit the face on the next turn.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's part of the skill that people do overlook at times.
So, really someone just pointed the Blood Mage Downloads at the Knife Juggler, and it looks like he's thinking that the only way he wins this game is if he draws Ban right now.
Yes.
And doesn't do it.
But does draw SI7, which might just buy him one more turn.
Right. The only problem is that he missed out on the opportunity to kill a 1-1 here, potentially, with his Bloodmite Sentinels. Obviously, if he didn't go for the Night Dragon, that would have gone on to the
It's not going to matter, but if he hadn't drawn the Wolf Rider, I think No Tomorrow would have known there that he might as well have a good chance of going face with the Golem anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knows that Sleepy did that play to draw Fan. You can see that from this side of the board. So he would have known that he had the chance to go face with the Golem and that really the extra mana wouldn't make much difference.
Yep. And that's going to be it. I mean, you can draw cards, but you're not going to draw Innervate here. I mean, prep only works with spells, not minions. There's not going to be any healing. There's no Voodoo Doctor in here, and that wouldn't matter anyway. So just a formality, and that's going to be game four. No Tomorrow. The Rogue is finally out of the way, and Facehunter reigns supreme.
Facehunter reigns supreme, everyone's favorite phrase. I think we're going to get a Warlock now from Sleepy, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, Warlock. So it's going to be Warlock. We don't really know what it is. It
doesn't tell us anything.
I'm just going to guess that it's Reno. Reno or Malilock.
Yeah, there will be some mix of sort of demons and buffs.
Oh, there's Reno. So that there's answers Reno. That question. No, I mean, to be honest, if we saw Stalag, it would have been, okay, that's Reno. But a lot of the time we're like,
We see Imp Gang Boss.
Yeah, you're like, what could this be? Like, what is this? And it's like, oh, no, there's Reno. There he is. Found him. So yeah, it's going to be Reno Lock versus the Face Hunter. Classic matchup, and I think Sleepy Shaman already won, unless he somehow has any duplicates in his deck.
By winning the Reno lottery.
Yeah, exactly.
Every month in Reno.
It sounds anticlimactic, and occasionally the Hunter can maybe get, a kill by turn 5. Or, they maybe somehow can manage to squeak out enough damage because you're forcing your opponent to play Reno and you somehow have a board as the Face Hunter and you can kind of push damage afterward. But 99% of the time, if you have Reno against Face Hunter, you're winning the game.
He picked up the cue there instantly. No Tomorrow didn't play the Abusive Sergeant because he knows the setup was there for the clear.
Yeah, Demon Wrath. And Sleepy Shaman not even afraid to just get out this Zombie Chow, realizing that he just needs to get some board control, and he's not going to die. He has a few more turns. Actually, he's getting pretty low, though. So this is getting,
interesting, right?
A little bit scary, right? But he does have
every card in the hand does damage.
Right, but he does have the implosion that does play a little bit into the Unleash the Hounds. It was actually good that it didn't roll for 4. But are we going to actually see a situation where he dies before he gets to play Reno? That's not going to happen, right?
That would be so sad for the Reno.
That would be really, really sad. Especially for me, because I already called this game. But
so if he hits with a quick shot here, it puts it to 7 instead of 8. He's got 6 in hand. He's trying to find a way. He knows the situation here. He knows that it doesn't matter if there's no Reno. He'll win if there's no Reno. So he's got to try and find a way to win if there is a Reno. And he just can't get that number down one lower.
Right.
Desperately would have liked to put next turn lethal up there. And so, it looks like Reno's going to escape, but what could change it? Another Arcane Golem? No.
I'm not really sure, but I think you just play the Sunfury here, right? I mean, it shouldn't really matter too much. But I suppose he'll just hold onto the Sunfury for future turns to get a taunt up.
I think No Tomorrow knows what's happening here.
Yeah, you could just kind of look at his face like, what do I even do here? I don't know. I guess I'll just play this and play Hero Power, and if you have Reno, then congratulations.
Yeah, I think he knows it's coming, just from the way the game's been played by Sleepy.
Yep. So, a bit of a wry smile.
You're not even
there.
A glimmer there from No Tomorrow.
I mean, just a little smirk. I saw a little bit there. But yeah. Nihao coming out of Sleepy Shaman there. Basically, hello. Or greetings, I suppose. But I greet you. You know, thinking about it, Golden has the weirdest greeting. Who says I greet you, honestly?
The things he says are really scary and creepy.
Yeah, but
Feast of Wintervale was like, okay, what are you trying to do to me? I just want to play, yeah.
Yeah, but, okay. But, I mean, some of the things he says are creepy, but that's not just creepy. It's actually just bizarre as well. And looks like, oh my god. yeah, well placed. Boom bots are too good. They take out Arcane Golems, confirmed. But I suppose this game isn't over yet. I mean, he is down to 21, is Sleepy Shaman, and it's not guaranteed. Yeah. But there's a lot of damage on the board, and he has now the Refreshment Vendor. He has even more healing in that Siphon Soul, so... Gonna be a good guy, gonna heal up No Tomorrow for 4 here, but this is just gonna be over pretty soon.
And there is the other thing that we've said in every game so far, it is Last Hero Standing, so that there is a point to playing at least up to some, yeah, to some level of try to get a card out, cards off your opponent. And I just can't see him there because he was not even going to see another card.
Right.
And goes to 3-3, and the Battle of the Heavyweights goes to 1-1, so...
Yep, absolutely. And so, yeah, gonna be the Reno, obviously, for Sleepy Shaman coming back here. I mean, I think No Tomorrow thought he had maybe a 1% chance to win the game even after the Reno. It's, I mean, if the Warlock has absolutely nothing, you know, sometimes you can make that happen. But yeah, going to be one of his remaining two decks. I actually wasn't able to check that out. Did you catch that?
I didn't, I'm afraid, no.
Oh, no.
Oh, no, I did. It's his Druid and Hunter.
Okay, we're really bad at this, but anyway.
It's his Druid, Hunter, and Lock. I checked it when it came up originally after
All right. Awesome.
Shrink Soldiers. And
cool, cool.
I noticed it. So, Druid versus Reno. Druid is favored in this for me, but every now and again, Reno just gets some sort of god curve into Reno, and that's really hard to beat.
Right. I mean, it's kind of strange, right? When Reno first came out, I thought it would be even worse than Handlock at dealing with Druid. I mean, obviously, Handlock isn't the worst thing against Druid, because sometimes Druid just can't deal with the big minions that come out of it. But it turns out Reno's kind of a big deal as far as getting back to 30. Handlock, a lot of times, you know, Healbot just isn't enough. And just, you know, if you can only get to, you know, the low 20, sometimes Druid can just burst you out no matter what anyway. And yeah, just having some sort of, you know, nice sticky board or nice annoying board and, you know, competing with the Druid going back and forth. And then finally you go back up to 30 and you don't have to worry about combo. It's really refreshing. If you're the Reno.
Yeah, really refreshing. It refreshes your life total kind of way. What are we going to do here? Just draw a card?
Yeah, nothing else to do here. You might as well just draw a card. Go for one, use your hero power. You're basically taking one damage, two damage here to draw a card, which is definitely worth it over doing nothing.
So something you need to do here, I've heard other players describe it as well, is you need to do enough damage to the Warlock to make them Reno.
Right.
Assuming you can't just burst them for lethal in one go. But you need to the Reno to sort of... You try and force the Reno down without actually making it kill you by gaining too much life.
Yeah, that's definitely the name of the game. You kind of have to worry about things like, you know, Molten Shadowflame is a thing. Obviously, there's only one of. But you kind of just, you know, play it out and count all the things that they use so far. You know that's only going to be one. Nowadays, Reno Locks can't really afford to play two of anything because Reno just basically dies or doesn't do well against aggro, as we see. Sometimes lucky for Sleepy Shaman, never lucky for No Tomorrow here.
Yeah,
rolls a 4 there. But, I mean, I guess...
Yeah, the theory when it first came out...
Yeah, so I guess five-phase interface Shredder is pretty good to counter that. But what were you saying? Sorry.
The theory when it first came out was you could get something like 2 Peddlers and 2 Molten Giants in, and you'd be all right. Reno would still be okay. But actually, I think it's just evolved to the point where people realize that we're playing this Reno to beat aggro decks. We can't afford to get to turn... Like, past turn 6 in that last game would have been a disaster if you needed to draw a second something.
Yeah, exactly.
And by turn 6, there is a good chance you haven't drawn both of your whatever they are. And so, yeah, they just now play one of everything and draw them on curve anyway.
Yep.
If possible, so.
So
joking aside, like, we have seen that, I've said this earlier as well, we're learning that the power levels of cards in Hearthstone are much closer than our brains have sort of programmed them to think they are. The
right.
difference between a Shredder and a Yeti, for instance. Like, oh, we play 2 Yeti Shredders, they're better. Well, yes, they're better. And you can play 2, so you do. But actually, when you're forced to play one of each, or one of something, or one of something else, there's not much in it in Hearthstone cards.
Yeah, definitely. It definitely makes a difference. I mean, over the long run, having a super, you know, streamlined deck with all the best cards is really nice to have. But if you're able to put something as devastatingly powerful as Reno to basically reset a game... you go for the slightly weaker card in that situation. But in any case, for this game, No Tomorrow has done a pretty good job putting the pressure on the Sleepy Shaman, making Sleepy Shaman play a bit aggressively here. And, that's a nice card. That's a nice... I mean, good for this. I mean, it has immediate impact, right? It's kind of like having charge here. You can go for a 4-mana Wrath.
Four mana wrath onto the Drake. The other thing he's doing a good job of here is he's going to make the Reno happen soon, most likely, whilst he's still got a bunch of damage in hand. It's going to be really close to see how this goes.
Yeah, Sleepy Shaman definitely wants to... I mean, the ideal situation for Sleepy Shaman would be to be able to get low enough that he can play Molten and Reno on the same turn, but that's really tough against a Druid.
Yeah, and this board is actually pretty tough to get through. That 1-1 is protected now. Don't really want to Demon Wrath all your own guys. Demon Fire? The thing that does 2 damage to anything anyway.
Demon Wrath, yeah.
Demon Wrath. And I assume he'll wait to play the Molten Giant for 3 later on, or maybe not if he's in a Reno. He's got no buffs for it anyway. You don't just want to play it on its own.
Right.
And I mean, one thing that strong players do get out of Reno Lock is so much versatility in their choices.
Mm-hmm.
When you get into the mid and late games, you've got a choice between basically any sort of effect you want to use. I'm a big fan of Raven Idol, by the way, in Druid.
He's got himself a coin here. Happy. obviously, Astral Convene is not going to be the one. Starfall is actually kind of nice. You can just go through a taunt and hit the face after you've maybe gotten them pretty low. Or Starfire, excuse me.
That's not just 5. Yeah. And draw a card.
Right. Innervate would have been reasonable as well, but at the moment, I mean, he has cards as well. The one thing I was a bit confused about was how quickly Notamar reached for that Raven Idol, especially because he had, you know, a few options in hand, but maybe it won't make a difference. That Boombot Hitting Face is actually a huge deal. Now Sleepy Shaman can basically just go tap into Molten Giant and Reno Jackson, which I imagine he'll do, though he doesn't...
He now has to do it.
Yeah.
He doesn't know, but this Starfire going 5 to face could top deck into a Swipe, and that'd be game. So,
right, and then obviously there's a matter of the Doctor Boom as well, but yeah, it looks like he's just gonna go for that. Does he want to go Jiraxxus? This is kind of interesting.
Does he lose if he plays Jiraxxus? I think he loses if he plays Jiraxxus. It's really close.
So he's going to go ahead and tap first. He might as well. It's a free tap. And I'm going to play the Reno out.
Everyone breathes. Everyone in his team goes, oh, thank goodness.
It's kind of an issue, though, because he might have been able to use Siphon Soul on that Dr. Boom rather than use Reno, and he kind of was forced into it because of what happened here. On the other hand, he does have a pretty big board, and he should be able to deal with this Dr. Boom next turn no matter what, even after this Big Game Hunter. And then after that, he has Siphon Soul for anything else that comes out. The one thing he doesn't have is an answer for Savannah, but it looks like that's not coming out this turn.
Yeah, quite a bit's going to go on here. He's probably going to make the 4-6 taunt here.
Mm-hmm. Most likely.
And that makes the board sort of reverse back in his favor for No Tomorrow pretty quickly. Obviously, then Reno can do the same thing because he's got a good hand as well. Give me a bit of a back and forth go on here for the next 2 or 3 turns to see who can get this board. And obviously, Warlock, in that situation, often wins that race because it has the card draw.
Huh.
But all the time now, that Sleepy Shaman has to play around the fact that everything that No Tomorrow does represents lethal, even though he hasn't got the force in hand.
Right. So this is a bit curious. No Tomorrow actually went for the Keeper of the Grove. And he just saw a Fugit, obviously. So if there's a Stalag later, he doesn't have the Silence in hand to deal with it. So that could be a bit of an issue later.
Yeah, I'm not sure how much you worry about that. Like, I think you get the feeling that if it comes to that, you've lost anyway. And if it really comes to it, well, it's got to hit you twice, so you go around the sides and have too many things for it.
But what if Sleepy Shaman just kills the Dr. Boom and plays it out right now? Then
you probably lose.
So, I mean, maybe you just rely on the Sylvanas, but maybe your opponent has Owl, so... I guess he just wants to play a bit risky here and wants to just be as aggressive as possible.
I think he saw that board getting out of control immediately and decided there was no tomorrow and just had to sort it out right now.
Right.
Because that board was looking pretty scary. Let's see.
So, Sleepy Shaman here, just using a Demon Wrath just to clear out. Basically... a really expensive, or not expensive, basically what he did was go with Drain Life, but it had kind of the extra effect of dealing 2 damage to the Keeper, and it didn't heal himself, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. And showing off the Harrison, so again, information war. If he does happen to win this, then it's not a surprise to see Harrison Druid in a tournament
form. Wow, Sylvanas Shadowflame. So he's going to take a 4-1 here and basically clear the entire board. I mean, it seems a bit wasteful, right? The Sylvanas Shadowflame is one of the most powerful things in this entire game, but I think that was a pretty big effect there. I think it was pretty useful.
I mean, you can tell it's a big effect without knowing anything about Hearthstone, because Sleepy went straight for his water. It's like, oh, look at me, I'm winning again.
I mean, what I'm trying to say is, you know, you typically associate, you know, Sylvanas Shadowflame with dealing with an entire handlocks board of giants and stuff like that, but even that, I mean, just so much pressure on the board coming to a Sleepy Shabbat, and he's like, nope, just gone, sorry.
And dealing with a 4-6 was kind of awkward, it was going to injure your guy, so yeah, it's good to just deal with it by stealing it, even if it's only a 4-1. It's just another thing that Notomar has to get through.
By the way, going back two turns to the Harrison Jones play, No Tomorrow knows that Sleepy Shaman would be insane to play out Draxus right now. So even though he knows that Draxus is in the deck, there's no way it's coming out anytime soon.
Yeah, if you're playing at rank 14 or ladder, you keep that Harrison forever.
Exactly.
Because they're going to let you have eight cards at some point. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And we saw the Dr. Boom. We saw the Big Game Hunter before, but now no Big Game Hunter for the Dr. Boom here. But there is a Sylvanas, which obviously is an issue. So if you're Sleepy Shaman, what do you go for here? You could actually start, you know, Mortal Calling your own Imking boss to put more ones on the field.
The one off lethal, so.
Oh, right. I wasn't even looking at that. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, yeah. So that's something.
So you probably just make sure you get something into face here, no matter what you decide to do. And. In fact, he's even tapped probably to try and hit. Oh, you couldn't hit lethal because the Draxus wouldn't be able to play there. But yeah, you probably make sure this 7 just goes into face now. You're not expecting the Druid to miraculously heal itself for more than 5. And if it does, then it's not drawing cards. If he has the Ancient, which we can see he has, but. Yeah, going with your play of, well, what you're going to steal, I can sort it out, whatever you do.
And, I mean, Sleepy Tom's obviously able to just go with his play and, you know, kill out the. Dr. Boom, nice and easy there, because he knows there's not going to be any more 7 or attack more creatures left. Plays out the Healbot, which I think he doesn't really care about the healing too much. He just did that because he can play this Ooze whenever he wants, whereas that's not the case with the Healbot. And he does heal for 6, which is, you know, significant.
Yeah, just putting everything out of reach here, and he's going to have next turn lethal for the rest of the game now, sort of. He's going to make his opponent deal with next turn lethal for the rest of the game. And No Tomorrow is just... What can he even do here? Suppose he didn't draw the cards before attacking just in case, but I think he knows this is over, really.
Yeah, I mean, maybe he was thinking that if he just draws... you know, or gets a Doomsayer off of that, then that might change his play or something.
I guess that's fair, yeah. No, that's actually fair. That was probably more likely to make a difference than anything he could draw in this situation.
Yep. Well, kind of an awkward turn here for Sleepy Shaman. Kind of, there's no real use for this Siphon Soul from here on out. So just going to go ahead and use that there. And gets rid of his own Inking boss. I mean, I kind of liked it just being annoying there, but I guess it doesn't really make too much of a difference using that rather than the Healbot. Could have actually hit both the face as well, if you wanted to.
He's put down next turn lethal again, though. He's put down the 7 with the Draxus 10. I think he figures that if Notomo has to keep tapping, then so be it. It's 2 mana he's not spending as Druid each turn, which is really important.
This game isn't completely over, though, by the way. No, I mean, we're talking about how Sleepy Shaman has kind of taken control, but looking at his hand, there's a lot of unplayable. I mean, all those are unplayable right now, so. I mean,
yeah, it's... And have we used both Innovates as Notomo?
I think so. I'm pretty sure.
So double combo is not an option.
Yeah, so it's not. Unless he. Has he played Thorason? I don't think so either.
I don't remember seeing any reduced cost cards.
Right, so all these games are blending together, obviously. Especially because Thorason is played in a lot of decks.
I don't think he has. So yeah, Thorason or if he hasn't played the other Innovate, but we think he has.
Well, there's a Thorason. But by the way, I do like this play of the Refreshment Vendor. I mean, it's not that advanced, obviously. Most players would make this play, but there's a Thorason, by the way. But it just, you have to get this mini on the boards. I mean, just because it heals your opponent doesn't really make too much
difference. And this is really in the balance now, because double combo is something like 22 damage, 14 plus 8. Yeah, 22 damage.
Yeah, it's 22 damage from hand, which means that you'll go over 30, or 31 if you have the Thoris on field. So that guy has to die right now. Also, Sleepy Shaman hasn't seen those cards played for a long, long time, so he basically knows that that's double combo.
Yeah, he's going to get to draw a card from Mortal Coil here before he brands into some sort of...
Mm-hmm.
He's used Peddler, and it's Reno, so he probably hasn't got another Peddler. There is a chance, but... No, because... Yeah, there is a chance there's another Peddler, but it's very small. But Brand, we haven't seen many things that work with Brand, so... Chances are he's got something he can pick up with it.
Sunfury is reasonable. He can double taunt. No, that doesn't really work.
Yeah, he can taunt the same guys twice.
You kind of have to tap here. I don't see... Unless he's really running out of cards... I feel like he kind of needs to tap here, yeah. So, there is Stalag, by the way. So that could make a huge deal, and yeah, there's no silence in No Tomorrow's deck,
no, he's used both silences, because he just used one a moment ago to kill the 3-3.
Right, so you kill off this Thorsten. Actually, maybe you don't need to? Question mark?
I think you do.
I mean, it is 9 damage, so, but yeah, just put this Stalag on the board. It's a lot of damage, and if you kill it, it's 11 damage, so... By the way, there's double combo.
So yeah, good job you killed that Thorison, right? Otherwise, really bad things might have started happening here.
Yeah, I have seen double combo. I don't even want to remember how much damage it was, but
it's a lot of damage. It's 12 multiplied by some numbers involved.
I have lost to that combo, and it was really sad because they had so many Thorison rounds go off, and I finally stabilized, and then he double comboed me, and. It was very, very sad.
I assume you said well played and just conceded the game casually.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
After you picked your mouse up from the wall.
But, so yeah, it's just going to be a combo here.
He's going to put the 11-11 in to get through the stuff.
Uh-huh. But, I mean, he needs to get through it eventually, but, I mean, at this point, I mean, that sequence of draws Stalag into the Sun Fury, I mean, that was just basically game-winning. I don't see how No Tomorrow gets himself out of this, because he can't kill his opponent. Right, and that's how you win the game. And basically, the only way that No Tomorrow can win with this particular deck is to kill his opponent, and he can't kill his opponent anymore. And not only that, he's about to die very, very soon. In fact, there's lethal on board for Sleepy Shaman, so that is going to be it. Sleepy Shaman actually takes the game versus No Tomorrow with the second deck that both these players are playing here. And it's going to be up to No Tomorrow's Warlock to be able to take out the Warlock of Sleepy Shaman.
And the key there with it being Last Hero Standing is that No Tomorrow chose to play that Druid.
Right.
So that's the deck he thought had the better chance. So whatever Warlock it is, which may still be a mirror match, it may be a 50-50, because obviously the Druid... I'm still here, guys. I need more water.
Yeah. Exactly.
Why did you only give me one bottle? You know I'm going to be here for 2 hours.
Absolutely.
Great, look. So it could be a 50-50 because the Druid is favored against Reno, but... Obviously, when you beat the guy's counter deck, then you obviously feel pretty good.
Yeah, exactly. It could be the case that maybe he's kind of misjudged the matchup. Because, I mean, you were mentioning earlier you felt that Druid was strong against Reno Lock. But I have just seen so many times Reno Lock beat Druid. I mean, I've casted more games, definitely, that Reno Lock has beat Druid than the other way around. So it might be kind of a misjudgment. Maybe he feels like a better chance. But we're looking at Zoo here, so perhaps he was right in his judgment that the Druid was a bit better. By the way, Yolo Miracle here taking the lead for the first time in this overall series. It started out 0-2, got back to 2-2, and then went to 2-3, and now they're up 4-3. So got to feel good for their side, and really well done by Sleepy Shaman here.
Interesting mulligan there from Sleepy. He chose to keep... The Twilight Drake, the Hellfire, and the Farseer. You can't keep much more of a mixed hand than that for not knowing what your opponent's doing.
Right.
Keep a Drake because it's kind of good in the mirror. Keep a Hellfire because it's kind of good against Zoo. Keep a Farseer because it might heal something from 3.
You know, I think I've kept that exact hand before.
Well, for the same reason, it's like, I can do some things, I just don't know which things I need to do, but exactly. I can do them.
And to be fair, awesome. If you're on the coin, the Twilight Drake isn't actually that... you know, clunky.
Uh-huh.
You can just kind of okay, that's actually really painful that the blood and the buffing the Void Walker. Although it doesn't really make too much of a difference. I mean, it's gonna be a 1-1 after this, but
Demon firing these guys down though, when these imps come to play.
Sorry?
I was going to say good luck using the Demon Fire to kill the guys when the Imps come out in a minute.
Yeah, especially because Demon Fire does 2 damage. Ah, I'm just kidding. So it is Demon Wrath.
Oh, is it Demon Wrath? I never know which one's which.
It is Demon Wrath, yeah. Demon Fire is the one, and is the one
that's really bad one.
Buffs by 2. It's reasonable. It used to be used, actually. It used to be actually in circulation. Back in the day, the broken thing, quote-unquote, back before there were many more broken things, the broken thing to do with Zoo was to play Flame Imp on turn 1 and Demon Wrath on turn 2, and then you had a 5-4. Or you played...
Okay, so I'm thinking of the other one, the really bad one, Demon Fuse.
Yeah, that's the really bad one. Yeah.
So now we've got the Owl that's going to kill this Drake, you would think.
Yeah, most certainly. I mean, you can Owl maybe a Taunt later, but there's only one Sun Fury, and maybe not even a Defender. Usually there's a Defender, but not always. So yeah, just you basically want to do this now, especially as a Zoo. You want to just take care of the board, or take control of the board, excuse me. And this allows you to do that. You're basically trading anyway. You're not a face deck that needs to just get through.
Done good work there as well.
Sorry?
Like 2-4 and a 2-5 for Reno to deal with aren't actually the easiest things for it to deal with anymore.
Oh, right. Yeah, the Blood Imp. Yeah, the Blood Imp did a good job. He's a trooper. But, I mean, we could see Hellfire plus Mortal Coil here. He would get pretty far down, but maybe he could reno the turn afterward. Could also see something like... it's actually hard to see what that card is. I think he's facing the left. I think that's a Fugin. But that's kind of obviously a bit risky. Looks like he is going to go for the Mortal Coil first. And picks up a Big Game Hunter, which is actually not too bad against Zoo. Yeah, now it's just going to go for the Fugin to help him out against this board. 5 damage on the field, very, very unlikely to die. In fact, almost impossible, I believe. But gonna go for implosion here is no tomorrow. Hits for 3. Fair and balanced. I love fair and balanced implosions. 3 damage, 3 imps, everyone's happy.
Yeah, that sounds good, because that's what you're all expecting, even though it only is that actual number one time in 3.
Which is to say never. But yeah, so anyway, going to be... He might go for a Dark Bomb and a Hellfire, speaking of Sleepy Shaman, which would completely clear the board, but not really sure you're too worried about 2-1-1s, though, I mean, I guess the damage does add up, so...
Yeah, it needs to be a little bit careful, so...
That is his last Dark Bomb, though, and he's already used Demon Wrath and Hellfire, so he has Shadow Flame, and that's it. But, I mean, I suppose his minions just basically outdo the minions from Sleepy Shaman, or excuse me, from No Tomorrow. And if he does see something pretty huge, he can just use Big Game Hunter. So, Sleepy Shaman's put himself in a reasonable position here.
There's a twisting there that's still to come at some point if it comes really desperate as well.
Wait, have we seen that?
Well, actually, we didn't see it, did we?
Yeah, you don't always play Twisting Nether in Arena Lock.
And, okay, cool.
Yeah. But, yeah, kind of an awkward turn here for No Tomorrow. I mean, you're basically putting 2 damage on the board, which is not the greatest. I mean, you could commit your Abyss of Tarzan as well, but that's also iffy. You've seen the Mortal Coil, though, so it's not too bad.
Yeah, there's also the option, obviously, to just take in the Doom Guard, but then you just walk into Siphon Soul if things go bad, or whatever. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And...
So, the question here... Okay, looks like it's going to be Implosion. I was going to say, the question here is... As it rolls for 4. Sleepy Shaman is definitely good at this game. but I was wondering if he was going to be greedy enough to go for the Dr. Boom. But seeing as how his opponent didn't do anything, and since he has Reno in hand, it would be very sad if he just died there. And so, I can definitely see him playing a slightly safe here. And, oh my god.
Wow.
Rolls for 2.
Getting so fair and balanced.
So this is my theory that I posited to Rapid. The reason why Sleepy Shaman got 4 there is because he only runs 1 implosion in his deck. The Hearthstone gods told, the RNG Hearthstone gods told No Tomorrow, you run 2, that means you're cheating, so therefore I'm only going to give you less than 4.
Yeah, that's fair, cool. I like that. So this was your idea or Rapid's idea?
It was my idea, Rapid laughed.
Yeah, you're a sick man. it probably makes sense. And how did he get out of this? I mean, No Tomorrow... I'm sorry, Sleepy Shaman is showing a lot of experience here as well by not panicking about his life total and sort of dropping the Reno too early, just developing his board, obviously in a sensible fashion.
Yeah, a lot of in-between play by him, right? He was safe enough that he wouldn't die to anything, but at the same time, he didn't panic, which is what I really like. You can go the other way, right, and be too bold and just play out stuff, and then you just die, right, which can happen from time to time.
Yeah, he chose to heal himself, for instance, just so he could keep the board thing going without committing the Reno. But, like you say, not actually dying in the process. Really well navigated so far, to be fair.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to see a kill onto this Void Caller. And for No Tomorrow's sake, the best minion does come out. But I'm going to see Shadowflame on Stalag and get out a Thaddeus, which is kind of nice. I would say that's pretty good. wow. Right. That would
and
be a Thaddeus.
Just dawned on me. Now I know why this game's over. I just realized why they printed Beneath the Grounds.
You mean the...
To counter this card that was coming up.
Beneath
the Grounds, you put three things the same into your opponent's deck.
Oh, wait, what? I'm confused. Anyway,
so
Sleepy
if you
Shaman
Beneath the Grounds as rogue against Reno, it counters it completely.
Oh, right. And you can't play...
So that would be why they printed the card, because they do always make sure a card has one counter printed.
You went off on a crazy tangent. I thought you were talking
about
Thaddeus.
So yeah, I know. Once you get that game thing, this game's over. How do I beat this damn deck? And that was it.
I was like, wait, how does Beneath the Grounds, how does that counter Thaddeus? What?
Because now we're going to get a rogue come out with Beneath the Grounds in to beat this Reno Lock. That's what's going to happen. Okay. And that's, in fairness, it's 5-3, Sleepy Shaman. He's gone straight through Bings Run 2-0, and now he's gone through No Tomorrow 3-1.
Wow, that is...
And he's still got his second bottle of water.
Absolutely. If this were a single elimination tournament, he would have been in an absolutely fantastic shape. In any case, looks like we are going to go to a break. I believe that is 5-3 in favor of Yolo Miracle. When we come back, we could see the conclusion of this game and see who goes to the finals to face off against Team Celestial. Don't go away.
We are honor.
We are courage.
We are justice.
We are compassion.
We are determination.
Nobody knows about the kind of show that go out, we know that he says. Nobody cares about the kind of show that go out when you crash last. Nobody knows about the kind of show that's like Johnny Boone from Mass. Nobody cares about the kind of show that could show you out.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Hearthstone Team Story, guys. I am D2. With me is Lorinda. Unfortunately, Shrink's mic is not agreeing with him, so he's not joining us on the Skype call at this very moment. But we currently have Sleepy Shaman on a rampage, going 5-1 so far with his decks and really putting it to EDG. And now it looks like they're going to go with Nicholas, aka Love Xiao Bu, to be able to counter him. What do you think about this pick here, Lorinda?
I actually haven't seen the decks, but... obviously, this guy is experienced. He can play Hearthstone a lot. He's already played today, played very well earlier. He played Paladin and Rogue earlier. Well, he won't be playing Paladin again now, so perhaps he's playing the Beneath the Grounds Rogue.
you really just hate Reno. It's like, whatever could beat this Reno.
Yeah, just play 30 cards and beat that deck and get in there. So it looks like it's Warrior and Rogue this time around. So...
Right. And Warrior...
I think it would be the Warrior that he was going to play. Unless he thinks that he's got Patron, maybe?
Neither Warrior does well against Reno.
And doesn't feel like it would do well.
If you don't know the reason why, it's because you can't really pay... all your Patron stuff gets cleared out by the AoEs in the Reno lock. Mm-hmm. And if you're basically... I mean, obviously you have more minions than that nowadays, ever since, you know, the Warthog nerf, which we've gone on about... But the Reno can deal with that as well. What is this? Okay, that's just Alexstrasza. And so it's going to be the Control Warrior. And I was about to get the Control Warrior. And the reason why the Control Warrior doesn't work either... And when I say it doesn't work, I mean they're capable of winning. I would say the Control Warrior has a slightly better chance. But the reason why is because you can't just armor up all day and hope to outlast them, which you would think you'd be able to do, but there's this thing called Duraxis, which is able to just kind of, you know, ruin your day.
So this... is interesting to me, because I wouldn't have thought this was one of the good matchups at all that they had left, although I can't see what the other two decks were. I wonder if he's got some sort of slightly weird tech in here that would make a difference, like a Elise, for instance.
Nefarian into Guaranteed Sacrificial Pact?
Sure, go with that.
That's the one. That's the thing.
That's how you win this matchup.
Right. So, I mean, Sleepy Shaman... I mean, Sleepy Shaman's a smart guy. I wonder what he's thinking looking at this. He's thinking, well, don't I just beat you? Why did you pick this deck?
Yeah, so that's what he's going to be telling himself not to think, right? As a pro player, you're sitting there going, I just beat you, but you're not stupid. You've been to World Championships. I'm going to have to actually think about this. But until then, I'll just beat you until I see what the deal is. Because we're seeing nothing here. And maybe Nicholas just likes his matchup for some reason. I mean, some people are just really good at matchups sometimes, even when they're underdogs.
Right. But... I mean, there could be a way to kill Duraxis. I mean, basically, that's how you win this matchup, right? Is you... and we have the Justicar coming into the hand here. So, basically, we might just see Love Xiao Bu here. Stall, play Justicar, play, you know, just tank up the entire time, and then when Draxus finally comes out, you...
Harrison.
You Harrison, there is that, but it doesn't really help too much. You equip Gorehell, maybe? And then from there, you kind of set up a situation where you your opponent can't really put up too many taunts because you brawl them, and then you set up a situation where you're eventually going to be able to kill him with Grom. So maybe he has some sort of, you know...
Sure.
I mean, it kind of works in a way.
It is one of it is the sort of matchup where I can imagine somebody getting really good on the wrong side of it, if you like. Like, because it is a complicated matchup at the very least. So, I mean, like I say, some people are just good at some matchups from either side. And maybe it's just one that they said, well, we don't like any of our four remaining decks. What do you fancy? And he says, I can do it with a warrior. Let's go.
Right.
But other than that, I can't think of anything like apart from what you've described, which seems messy.
Sleepy Shaman's really good at this game, by the way. Let me just point that out there.
Yeah, he knows to roll four on that card. Definitely knows it four. And he never flinches. Like, he just rolls it if it's supposed to roll four.
It's like, let me just play this implosion. I think if we snuck over to Sleepy Shaman's computer and looked over his shoulder, it would say, deal four damage.
Make 4 imps.
Seems pretty good. What do you think about just using Revenge here? I mean, where is Revenge going to be too much better? You might want to save it for, you know, being able to activate Execute, and maybe you hold on to your Cruel Task for your Grom.
Sure, I'd rather develop something that does something, I think, but I'm trying to work out that there's no point not revenging and just playing your Sludge, because he's just going to get through that anyway.
Do you just play
same
Justicar?
Deal with your Shield Maiden. I guess you kind of have to revenge.
I mean, if you play Sylvanas, he can just throw everything in and then Mortal Coil, potentially, which is not
I
the greatest.
I guess you can Justicar. He's looking at that. I don't like the Sludge much, because you're just playing into Mortal Coil here.
Yeah, and the other thing to think about with Sludge Belcher is that there are actually not too many taunts in the Warrior, and it seems strange because you're going to get so much armor, but sometimes you need to protect your own minions, and sometimes you need to just, you know, not take damage in certain spots, especially if you're going to be facing Draxus later on.
Yeah.
So just having that one taunt there, it can be really devastating.
And the Revenge doesn't, as you point out, won't do much later anyway. It wasn't my instinctive pick, but maybe Justicar would have been okay, I think, as well.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the fact that you can't really play anything with Revenge, I thought about it for a second, but I think you're right. It's probably not the best to play it. But I think Justicar would have been perfectly fine here. In any case, there's a better use for Revenge here. He's able to use that in concert with his Death Spike to take out this Thorison. Uh-huh. So ends up working
out. So he's
managed
to keep his guy on the board, get some damage in, and still use the Revenge the next turn, so that's fine. That works. Maybe that was in his mind, that everything that was coming down that turn has 5 toughness or something like that.
Mm-hmm. So Sleepy Shaman, unfortunately, doesn't throw his imps in and gets them all killed by Revenge, but, I mean, you do get Revenge out of the way, which is, you know, one less activator for Grom, potentially, one less thing that could take out things like these Boombots. So that is a consideration.
And something you pointed out here, Sleepy's deep in thought. He's like, why is... It's got to be partly, why is he playing this deck against me?
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm pretty confident that this is a really powerful matchup for Reno.
Right. Basically, it's not just that, I think, though. I mean, Reno is favored, I would say, but it's also very difficult to play both sides of this matchup. Basically, if you play the matchups perfectly, I feel like Reno just wins.
Yes.
But that involves you playing perfectly, so there's that caveat. So I feel like that, you know, Sleepy Shaman definitely wants to play this well, doesn't want to let his team down.
Yeah, and showing the determination again to just, you know, just I'm just going to sit here, guys. You've got to come and beat me.
Right.
As he's given that whole, well, that aura about him right from the start. We won't be executing our Sylvanas, guys, before anybody says that.
yeah. Shout out to Artosis, but who is actually back doing, you know, GSL cast, which is super awesome.
Awesome. Yeah. That's really good news.
But yeah, we see the owl onto the Sylvanas. Basically, the only thing that you're going to owl, I mean, you might want to owl a Grom, but if you're owling Grom, you're in a really bad spot anyway.
Yeah, you're either winning or losing by miles already.
Wow.
Oh, he knew.
And he even has the Mortal Coil as well. I mean, Sleepy Shaman is a very talented man. Just really good at game of Hearthstone.
This is the thing, though. We're sort of joking here, but when a good player has a bit of fortune on their side, goodness, they'll have to beat.
Exactly. And that was basically Kalenta for a long time. I mean, the dirty little secret about Kalenta was, he was obviously really good, but at the same time, there were a lot of matches where he got inexplicably just ridiculously lucky, and all the fellow pros were like, how does he do it?
Yeah.
And it was absolutely insane. It was basically impossible to beat him. When Kalenta was getting lucky, it's just, it's game over, and that's what we're seeing right now.
Yeah, you want to play against the best player in the world and his RNG. Thanks, guys. Exactly. It wasn't tough enough already. It's like... let's just add it a bit tougher, make him impossible to beat.
Yeah. Crank up that difficulty level right there. But, Love Shabu is just in a really awkward spot here. Doesn't want to just throw away his Deathbite. I mean, if he could, he would face tank that. I'm sure if he had a Bash, he would just face tank that Dr. Wind. Wouldn't really think twice about it. But having to just use this as a Whirlwind just for an Execute just really feels bad for him.
Interesting to me. You can't say how it would have turned out, but interesting that this Jessica could have been on the board some time ago now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it could have been getting a lot more tank ups in the meantime. But does get up now, and there really is no way, despite all the damage that Sleepy Shaman has gotten at the face of Lo Shabu, there's really no way for him to kill his opponent anytime soon. So it's going to be up to Jiraxxus in their near or far future, depending on when he draws it. But yeah, for now, just looks like he's going to play out this Sludge Belcher. Again, Sludge Belcher, I mean, even more so for the side of the Arena Lock, that's one of your only taunts, and you're going to need that. You're going to need that if you're going to defend against a Grom, especially once you play Jiraxxus. You kind of need something on the field to be able to protect yourself.
And so how does this pan out now? Who's a control? I get the feeling that Sleepy Shaman is a control in the near future. Right, he's on defending just for now, and then he'll switch back to being the aggro again in a few turns' time when the Jiraxxus appears or near that time.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. He's just basically just not trying to die. He's trying to, to be fair, he's trying to get as much of a board presence as possible. So he's kind of playing like a zoo control. If that makes any sense,
Yeah.
Getting things as much stuff on the board, but not really looking to kill.
It's just interesting to me, the guy tanking up for four every turn is the aggro.
Right.
That is how it is, right? That's actually the situation here.
I mean, the thing is, for Lo Shabu, he can't let his opponent get into a situation where he can play Jiraxxus. That's the biggest thing here.
Yeah, because this armor soon becomes meaningless when it's taking a chunk of damage every single turn.
Mm-hmm.
It all looks very nice if it gets to 40 or 50 or even 60 life, but if you're facing down 3 6-6s you can't deal with, it doesn't really matter what your life total is.
And the thing is, the tricky part about this matchup is that if you're the Arena Lock and your opponent has a Fire War Axe in hand, you can't really play Jiraxxus because you just die. So that's the really, really tricky part about it.
That's really interesting, actually. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So, the other thing Nicholas obviously has to do, we've said this every time, is try and force that Reno down with a minimum of effort,
mm-hmm.
as well as maybe even force the Jiraxxus or Healbots and those sort of things. Just try and get all those things done. Because at the moment, Sleepy Shaman, at least when you're sat opposite him with 10 cards or 9 cards in his hand, he just seems to have infinite options against you. And you've got to play around everything in the whole of Hearthstone almost against these decks. That's something that makes it so difficult to play against.
So we saw no tap there, and Sleepy Shaman wasn't going to overdraw. So that's a bit of a strange play. He was tapping quite a bit before then, so maybe he's a bit afraid of going into fatigue. That's one way that the control warrior can win if they get to be too low. Nicholas, unfortunately, hovered over Sleepy Shaman's hand for about 1 second there, so I couldn't look at it.
Yeah, I was trying to catch it. I saw it coming, and I still didn't see what it said.
It's on the bottom. Yeah, there's a bunch of Chinese characters in the top, and then it's on the bottom there. But
it's more than six. I recognize the deck thickness changes at six. It's more than that.
Well, in any case, a lot of pressure being put onto Sleepy Shaman right now. He has to... he has a Reno, I think.
It's 13 to Nicholas and something.
Mm-hmm.
And he did it like 4 times, so it's probably close. So I'm going to guess it's between 10 and 11-ish.
Right. Well, while you're focused on that, I think the Sleepy Shaman has to Reno here. And it looks like that's what he's going to do. He's going to play out Stalag, and he's going to Reno as well. He basically had to. There's so much pressure on the board right here. And that's what basically Nicholas was looking to be able to do here, was to just put a lot of pressure on the board, play out the Lothab, no Shadow Flame coming out, and just messed with Super Shaman's turn there. But unfortunately, You know, Lovechop, who doesn't have Grom, so no way to really finish this game out. He could continue to pressure, and he can get rid of the Thaddeus as well, if he wants to do that here. But the more time he spends, I mean, he's committed a lot to the board here, so the more time he spends kind of, you know, messing around clearing the board,
yes,
the more time he's giving Sleepy Shaman to kind of set up the future turns.
But also, he has to control it to some degree, because, you know, get rid of this thing while you can, while you're comfortable with the situation.
Well, yeah, get rid of it before your opponent just Shadow Flames and they have the board. So, yeah. That's, yeah, definitely, I mean, it's definitely imperative that he does, so it's just really painful.
To now the card advantage, like, this is kind of the final push. If this push doesn't work, he's going to run out of cards really quickly here unless he gets to Harrison and Juraxis. But then, I'm pretty sure he's got 12 cards left in his library, so, you know, Harrison may not be the thing that wants to happen anyway. Sleepy Shaman will know there's a Harrison there, so he will have a good idea about it, at least. He may well not play Juraxis until the very last second in this match as well.
So, Hellfire Demon Rat does clear the board here. That could be what Sleepy Shaman goes for. Could accompany with a tap as well. Sylvanas is reasonable as well, but, I mean, if it, you know, rolls wrong, so to speak, you could be looking at a pretty disastrous situation. But looks like he is hovering over that Hellfire and Demon Wrath. Does have single target removal in that Big Game Hunter and the Siphon Toll for the future, so not going to be too worried about that. Even has, you know, if things get really hairy, he has Sylvanas plus Power of Whelming, so.
Yeah, and he only has to face two cards down. That's a really good top deck now, though. This is going to sort of draw a lot more of the removal out.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just BGH, really, but it's right. It's at least something to keep it coming. He's just got to keep top decking stuff. And
these boom bots are actually a really big deal. Looks like it's going to be the ooze coming down as well to take care of this fiery war.
I was wondering if he's going to use that later, but that's obviously.
I think he's seen two death bites, hasn't he?
Yes. So perhaps that was the last weapon.
Right. Unless there's some sort of gore hell in here, but these boom bots are actually pretty huge. If they can get really good, you know, trade, so to speak, then, you know, Sleepy Shaman has to start from scratch building this board, and the minions in his hand are very situational. He's going to want to play he wants to play the Healbot and the Earthring Forester after he plays Araxes, but if he gets too far behind here, he might need to play it right now. And yeah. Sylvanas isn't always, I mean, it's really, really good, but it won't backfire, but it won't be as effective sometimes as you hope it will be sometimes.
When I gave my imaginary armor numbers out earlier, I sort of went as high as 60 life. This might go beyond that, at which point it might start making a difference.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know, we're looking at 59 life at the moment. If it gets too high without any sort of board, then
do you think there's going to be do you think there's going to be Sylvanas power here? Because he has Draxus in hand now. Okay, looks like it's just going to be the refreshment vendor going into that. So he'd rather have a Sylvanas than a 5/5 and a 3/4, it seems like. But yeah, basically he's just flooding the board as much as he can right now because he's preparing for Draxus next turn.
Yeah, he wants to make sure that there's actually something he can do. And I think he wants to also lose some more life, so take some more resources from Nicholas before actually playing the Draxus and injuring himself for 7 needlessly.
Uh-huh.
But he's ready.
Yep, Drex comes down. For those of you who are thinking, why is he taking 7 damage? You need to do it right now. You can't waste any more time. I need to get those 6/6s on the board ASAP. And he has been able to do that, so I would give Sleepy Shaman a pretty big lead right here at this point.
Yeah, it's...
I mean, Harrison comes down, but
yeah,
it doesn't really matter too much. In fact, he might even start just fatiguing along with Sleepy Shaman here.
Yeah, just starting in fatigue.
Right, so let's see how many brawls are. There's actually a gore howl.
There actually is a gore howl. Holy. Yeah, that's going to help. Right. And there's a bash as well, so that's 10 damage you can do from hand.
Right, so this actually is a huge deal. Obviously, the fact that he has gore howl in hand. You know, and
so that can be used for potential lethals, but also to keep, you know, if one minion lives for one turn, now Sleepy Shaman loses the game from hand.
Right. Actually, there's lethal. Wait a second. Does Love Chopper just win the game?
He has
Grom. Yeah, he needs a taunt right now. Out of one of these cards that he discovered. And gets the Shield Bearer, so that is something. But he needs to trade with this Harrison and play the Shield Bearer. But there is the threat of Cruel Task Grom for the rest of this game, essentially. And we might even see Love Chopper just play out the Brawl, because he knows that that was a really desperate Dark Peddler there.
Yeah, he might as well do the Brawl now, I think. Just trying to work out his best lines. Is he in a hurry? I guess he's in some sort of hurry.
Shrink, if you could just turn down the overall gain on your mic, you can see, we can hear like the background and fuzziness, and your voice is very loud as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he's going for that Brawl. And if he doesn't put up a taunt, it's like, I hit you in the face and...
And you can't heal past 15, obviously, so...
It's going to be really hard to see how Sleepy Shaman gets out of this, and...
Wow, so
that
maybe Gore this...
Howl making...
I mean, I was kind of, you know, theory-crafting about how he would be able to do it, but yeah, that's like it's just going to be a game. I was theory-crafting how he's going to do it. Looks like he did have the Gore Howl for that, you know, final push, potentially. And obviously had the Harrison Jones as well to be able to, you know, basically guarantee draw in that situation. But
and I thought that was the fourth weapon when he played the Swampoos earlier as well. And he had to use it on the third weapon, which was kind of... At the time, sort of thought, well, why isn't he saving this for later?
Well, we saw that it was... he had played both Death Spites, so it definitely makes sense that he didn't want to wait for another Death Spite. He doesn't know the score hell either. But... yeah, this is going to be game for Love Chopper, and basically paid off, you know, his decision to go with the Warrior here. We were kind of questioning it, but definitely played this game extremely well, and is going to be rewarded for it. But
going to be an end of an era. That seat with all the empty water bottles is going to actually be occupied by somebody else.
Definitely.
Seems a long time since Rozicki was in that chair.
Yeah, and Rozicki was out of here right away, right?
Sleepy Shaman's got 5-2 in there. Absolutely getting his team into front 5-4. Assuming he's lost, because I think he's lost this turn. Yeah, so he has. And nice work, Nicholas. And that's a huge, huge win now, because now they've got Control Warrior.
Yeah, Control Warrior is pretty difficult to deal with, no matter what you bring. Control Warrior can just beat so many decks out there, so it's going to be difficult for Yolo Miracle to come up with an answer here. One thing to note, though, is that he didn't reveal his Gore Howl. And that's kind of a big deal, especially if there's going to be a control matchup later.
And this is where we find out if anyone has brought Murloc Paladin, I guess.
Right. That could
if there is a Murloc Paladin, this is when you play it. Because you can't beat it as Control Warrior. I think it might be the biggest mismatch in Hearthstone there's ever been, including Warrior Freeze Mage.
I don't know about that. I mean, you could Alexstrasza your opponent and kill them with Grom, and if they don't have the healing, then they can't really get out of that. So you can maybe just get minions, mid-sized minion on the board. I suppose it's extremely difficult to get enough armor to get out of that. But if you tank up really early and your opponent's just drawing cards the entire game, maybe. I just feel like Warrior against Freeze Mage is pretty ridiculous, but we are going to see Fu Oliver come on to play against Nicholas here, and Fu Oliver actually played earlier today. He played 3 best of 5 series. So
3 best of 5s already today?
Yes.
He played the whole group in a day. Is that how that works?
Yes, he played the... it just happened to be that he played in the decider match, a guy he didn't play in his first match. But yes, he did play every single person. And he played really good players. So he played Tiddler. He played LoveCX, who his own teammate, who went to BlizzCon this past year. And he played against Xingsu, who is a player on IG.
How did he get on?
I'm sorry?
How did he do? Can you remember? It was so long.
No, I do remember. I didn't want to spoil it, but...
Don't say that.
All right. So
I don't know. I was asking. There's no intonation in my voice. I actually don't know how people have got on. I was casting, so...
Right. You can go to my YouTube channel and watch that shameless plug there. But yeah, we are going to have this game, and we don't unfortunately know what Fu Oliver's decks are, so we're going to have to find out with you guys. They had a graphic earlier, but it was too fast for us to write down, and it wasn't really written anywhere on any site, so we're just going to have to find this out with you, the viewers. But what do you think he could play other than Morlock Paladin? Which
Oh, he's playing three decks. He's the designated player. So he's got Mage, Paladin, or Druid. And mm-hmm. he's going with Druid, which makes sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a traditional strong matchup. He's still got Aspirants in there, though, which is interesting.
Right. Yeah, I was about to remark on that. Aspirant makes this matchup much worse for Druid. Still favored for the Druid, but much worse. Because it's one thing that Warrior has no problem dealing with. Whereas the old mid-range Druid, with just, you know, basically only three drops and above, Wild Ghosts and Shades and all that stuff, basically, you know, pre-LOE. That
yeah,
deck,
it's interesting.
There's nothing that, you know, everything is difficult for Warrior to deal with, and Danas is certainly not that.
People have started taking the, and he's kept it in his hand as well, people have started taking the Aspirants out of Druid in recent times, mainly, as I understand it, because it's easy to mulligan for. So people know you've got an Aspirant, so they mulligan to kill it one way or another, depending what deck they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes away a lot of the power of the card. And it, obviously, either they're ahead of it in the Chinese scene, so they've been playing without it for a while, and so it's a surprise card again, or they haven't got around right. to take it out yet. And
exactly. It's kind of funny, right? You can look at that and say, oh my god, they're so far behind. Or you could look at that, they're so far ahead. They actually went through that meta already, and people started putting it back in because people, you were playing around it too much, or playing for it too much, or not playing it for it too much.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's hard to know which cycle of the meta. It's going to be one of those cards that comes in and out of the deck, for sure, depending on what people are expecting.
I was not expecting that. I was expecting basically just to put up a taunt, which is pretty difficult to deal with, even if you have a weapon.
Mm-hmm.
And now this Darnassus can die, which means that Falvor wouldn't be able to play Lothab next turn.
Yeah. I think this was his way of protecting it, though. Because then he can't play Harrison next turn either.
This is interesting. So, if you're Love Shop, what do you do here? Do you just kill off the Darnassus, or do you kill off the bigger creature? I think you just kill off the Darnassus.
I kill the Darnassus, yeah. And I don't see why not. I guess you've got to think about it, because you've got to expect a Shredder next turn now.
There's also...
You've got to expect your opponent thinks that your guy's going to die, right?
Uh-huh. There's also this play where you just clear everything and have a completely clear board, which, I mean, if you're Control Warrior and you're playing against a Druid and their board's clear, you just kind of breathe a sigh of relief. We're like, whew, okay.
Yeah, you're still above 14 this turn. Next turn, you're still going to be above 14. So...
And yeah, Fuller's just going to have to swipe this one too, which definitely doesn't feel too good. And, you know, free turn here for Love Shabu. Unfortunately for him, he has nothing to do.
He's
going to
just make a weapon.
Yeah.
And possibly even have to go face with it.
Does he go face or does he hold on to it? Because that makes a big difference. I mean, it's we can't really answer for him because we know the answer already, which is you hit the face because otherwise you just get pretty, you know, destroyed by Harrison. But that's going to be the case anyway.
We've just seen swipe versus go face with weapon in a match in Constructed Hearthstone.
Right,
that's kind of strange. And yeah, Harrison dies for his sins, so just gets that card and gets clobbered. And what we have to know, we've got three cards versus seven.
Right. Hmm. So, yeah, pretty advantageous position here for Fualiver. The one problem is that there's kind of a card on the board here already. I mean, there's like one and a half. I would actually consider the Armorsmith the half card, just because it doesn't really do too much. And I would consider the Deathbite the actual card, because look at right here, it just kills off this Lothab for pretty much free here. So that would be the card for card exchange. And now Love Shabu actually has the board, which is kind of the opposite of what normally happens, right? Druid is usually the one who kind of, you know, throws our cards out in the field, innervates everything, uses Wild Growth, and just gets their guys in the field. And, you know, Warrior is stuck with all these clunky cards and nothing to do, and they're just dying, and they don't know how they're going to get back in tempo. But pretty much the opposite here. And,
yeah, I'm not quite sure that either player is going to be happy with how this has panned out so far.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly Nicholas will be more happy, but I don't... They've both had sort of waste turns and things go against them.
Yeah, so there's things going for both players, right? Obviously, Love Shall Boo ahead on board, which is usually not the case, but you'd like to have more cards. And if you're, you know, if you're Fu Oliver, you're behind on board, which you don't want to happen as the person who's trying to kill your opponent. But you have, you know, some cards to work with, so
could that's be a worse. Living Root in a deck with two aspirants. What would he cut?
Substantial cards.
No, there's a Harrison, a Living Root, and two aspirants. There's something's gone. Maybe an Azure Drake or two, even from this deck.
Right. So this is kind of the problem with, you know, just blanket thinking that, you know, Druid just beats Warrior, because if you don't tech it correctly, it just doesn't. It's just Druid just beat Warrior so long that people just kind of got accustomed to it. You know, you play mid-range Druid, you play double combo, you're good, you win the game. Not so fast, or not so true here.
I was surprised he kept Aspen in his opening hand. Because I think you have to play a little bit slower. I mean, I'm not going to criticize for Oliver's choice of mulliganing, but I prefer to play a little bit slower with Druid against Warrior now. Just try to chip away at them down to 15 or whatever, 14, and then combo. Mm-hmm. And the Aspen feels like a big gamble that's not needed there. They've got the War Axe or whatever.
Yeah.
Sure, it speeds you up for a turn, but then you soon get behind again.
Well, I mean, he did keep the Harrison, so it's kind of a half and half, right? You have the Darnassus to just kind of be there, and it's kind of like a Wild Growth, but it can get taken out. But you get basically your tempo back, or not your tempo, your value back, excuse me, by playing the Harrison and getting that card. That's kind of like an Azure Drake in that situation.
That makes sense. So it's an all-encompassing decision to hedge his bets, I guess.
This is a very awkward turn, by the way, for Nicholas, because he can't Shield Slam / execute, or he can execute, I suppose, and play Dr. Boom, but then you throw away your Lotheb, but he can't Shield Slam and play his Dr. Boom at the same time.
What's he on here? 32?
32, yeah. So he's not going to die to a combo.
Six off lethal, I think, so.
Right.
That's how disgusting this combo is, by the way. If you have a minion on the board with it, it's like...
Yeah, that's it's pretty much how, you know, Druids work for a long time. It's kind of
like I realize. Yeah, it's like it's not a new thing, but it's still a disgusting thing.
Mm-hmm.
Especially given all the other things that have come and gone while Druids just carried on doing this.
I mean, to be fair, every single, you know, good deck has something broken like that, right? Just something crazy that allows them to win games in an unfair manner. But we do have a pretty clean kill onto this Lothab here. No BGH, obviously, in the hand of Fu Oliver. Cannot draw with that Wild Growth. Using combo, for instance, to clear here would be kind of painful, though he could do so, and just kind of, you know, push 9 damage to face with that Dr. Boom, throw some, you know, Treants in there, but yeah, obviously it's kind of, you know, up to him about what he does as far as what he hits with that.
You think he's killing at least one Boom Bot with his... Well, he's just going to do this huge clear. Okay, this is nice.
Well, I mean, basically the Boombot kind of made his decision for him, right? He's like, oh, that's 3 damage on that guy. I have 4 damage in my hand right now, so let's just go for that.
Yeah, suddenly becomes an easy turn. Exactly. 7, 9, 11, plus 6. So 31 next turn would be lethal if he doesn't armor up after the Shield Maiden and doesn't kill anything.
Yeah, I think he's going to kill at least something.
I think he might be aware of those things, right?
What do you think about... using a Boombot and then using Execute instead of Shield Slam, because Shield Slam will be more likely to be able to use later, but I guess Nicholas is kind of wanting these Boombots to be a threat on the board, so he's just going to leave up these Keepers.
Yeah, something I've noticed in the last probably 2 months is that the pro players in particular are using their Boombots a lot more sparingly now.
I do like that. I mean, these Boombots, they're really, really annoying. And a lot of times you just ignore them if you're the opposing player as well. And I do like just letting them be annoying the entire time instead of just giving your opponent kind of an out, you know, get out of jail free card by using them in a kind of not a great position.
I mean, they provide a huge strategic advantage in that you've got to allow for them doing 4 at any time, even though they probably won't.
Exactly.
So by just being there, they give you an advantage. And I think pros have only just, like I say, last 2 or 3 months, really started to play with that in mind.
Mm-hmm. So Grom does come in hand. I don't believe there's lethal. Especially if one of these keepers is cleared off. If he leaves one of them, I Wait, so there would be 19 with the shade.
He's not the same as you.
19 with the shade, and then plus, okay, well, he answered my question by just killing that off. There's no way there's lethal off of just this shade.
I
so,
think he answered
23?
The question. Well, I haven't added it up. I suspect it was really close the other way. That's why he suddenly changed his mind and went, oh, I better kill one of these guys.
I think it was 27, so I don't think he still had it. But just to clear it just in case, but, I mean, I was about to say before Love Shabu drew into the Grom that all the card advantage that Fualvar had is kind of starting to translate into something, because you could see the sequence of events coming, right? The Alexstrasza into the Big Game Hunter, and then from there, you know, Fualvar has a combo, plus he's drawing in the minions. But this Grom is going to be a huge deal here.
Yeah, it's going to be, if you get an activate, obviously, that could be game. Urgently need to hero power trade here, but then
the one big thing is that Grom was just top decked here, right? So
yeah, so there's no read.
Exactly. So he doesn't know what that is. Could be Brawl, so that could make him trade as well. You know, it could be some sort of damage. Corcoran Elite isn't lethal. Deathbite isn't lethal. I guess there won't be Corcoran Elite. I'm getting my decks mixed up here. But
it's been a long day of patrons and control warriors.
Exactly. But that is the Gorehowl. I mean, and that is
it
game.
Is enough.
It is game. 7 is more than 6. We are good at math. Alright. And Nicholas actually takes the game. And that is the tech that was not shown the previous game. That's going to be it. At least for this game. And really crazy sequence of events. Didn't show the Gore Hall the last game. You know, Fualvar comes in here and thinks he's going to win with Druid. But he has Living Roots plus double Darnassus. Almost takes the game anyway. And then in the end, the Gore Hall is the final damage. That's actually insane.
Now has Mage and Paladin left, and I think we can say it's probably Freeze Mage, and it's probably not Murloc Paladin. So I imagine he'll play Secret Paladin here, or similar Paladin. It might not be Freeze Mage, but that seems to be the deck of choice for most pros. And,
mm-hmm.
And we are getting the Paladin.
So, looking at the hand of Fualvar, that's looking like Secret Paladin, even though we don't see TV Secrets in hand. The giveaway is that, well, now there's a Secret Keeper, but the giveaway was the Haunted Creeper.
Yes.
But, yeah, I mean, this is slightly favored for Control Warrior, though there is only one Brawl in the deck of Love Shabu, and that's going to make a big difference. You really need that Brawl in time. Though he does pick up fireworks, it's kind of nice, but yeah, I mean the Secret Paladin could tempo him out of the game, especially with his clunky hand.
Yeah, I quite like this from the Secret Paladin side of the board as well. So it's probably one of those that's pretty much 50-50.
Yeah, the one Brawl is definitely a big deal, and it really matters whether he draws it or not. Obviously, you don't need both Brawls, but it's a matter of drawing the first one in the first place. Yep. And this is actually really nice for Love Shabu here. He had such a clunky hand, but then he drew Fire Warx, and now he's trying to slam to take out this mini-bot really easily. So
yeah, and to get another card, just get edge towards getting out of trouble with his baddish hand, which is suddenly turning into, you know, if you can draw anything to do next turn.
I mean, if he didn't draw, obviously it's kind of bad luck to draw the first three cards that he had in the first place. But if things continued the way they were, and he drew, you know, Shield Slam, Executed, that card right there, and it would have been game over. He would have played, you know, Sludge Belcher into a massive board, you know, Secret Keeper plus Mini Bot plus this right here, and then it's almost game over. You know, it's Coin, Mysterious Challenger next turn. As it stands, there's still a chance here for Fualvar, but it would have been absolutely game over if that Fireworks into the Slam hadn't come.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting how quickly he's got behind here. And how quickly the Warriors got into it. I don't think he's in front, but it's actually a game that, like you say, just wasn't going to be a game. Follower's hand is pretty disgustingly good, though.
I don't like this this event here, because you just saw your opponent pass, which means he probably has a 5-drop. I think if he had a Deathbite, he would have played it already. Or anything to play, really. Yep. So I don't really see him doing anything other than playing a 5-drop, which is going to be either Lothar or Sludge Belcher. And this is not going to get procced, and you're going to have to play Mysterious Challenger, because
and
why wouldn't you?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to play a Secret before you play the Mysterious Challenger, because that's one less card that gets pulled out of your deck.
He could wait a turn. He could go for the juice over into the get down here, but then maybe your opponent plays another minion, so... I mean, to be fair, you kind of want your opponent playing minions, not really dealing with your board. But at the same time...
I think you do wait here, you know? I think you... Because now you've got the second secret in your hand.
But do you play the get down as well? Or, I mean, the thing is, you can't just... you can't just wait for your opponent to proc both of these secrets before you play the mysterious.
Yeah, I play the get down as well. Okay. The synergy with Avenge is worth it, even though he's probably not going to do it now. At some point, that synergy is going to be worth it. And you may top deck something like Boom next turn.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's worth playing the get down and just see what happens.
Looks like he's going to go for Coin Hero Power because he has a Mysterious Challenger anyway.
Yeah. I mean, okay. No reason why not, I guess. I would have saved it in case of top deck Boom. I know it's only like a 1 in 20, but it's such a significant 1 in 20 that I'd probably have kept it.
Mm-hmm. This just, the 3-1-1s on the board do deal with this Jessica, so there is that. Though I'm not sure if he will do it, maybe just hit with his True Silver. Let's see how many secrets comes up. It's going to be 4 total, which means there's either no competitive spirit or no repentance, and it will be up to Lojong.
You have fewer people playing repentance now.
Mm.
It used to be simple that it wasn't competitive spirit, but actually I'd go with it's not repentance more often these days.
Mm-hmm. This is a big deal here for Love Shabu, however. He's going to have to figure this one out. And looks like he's leading off with this Armorsmith, potentially. Going to see what it is. Sees that it's not repentant, so yeah, it's going to be the competitive spirit. And this is just pretty
Which
awkward.
Which explains the coin into the Hero Power last turn, actually.
Uh-huh, yeah, that absolutely does. So Sludge Belcher is sitting in front of an Armorsmith. It's pretty good. Typically gets you a lot of armor that way, so... Pretty reasonable turn there for Lao Xiaobu. He will be getting, you know, obviously 4 health out of his hero power here, from here on out, since that is a tank up. But he is definitely behind on board, and he can't really just shield slam that Mysterious Challenger because it just comes with that because it's 6-1. So this is a pretty awkward situation right now.
Wow, and he gets the...
Was that a misplay?
The right divine shield. Sorry?
Was that a bit of a misplay? Do you think maybe he should have attacked first?
What, to make sure it ends up on the challenger?
No, because you'd rather have a 7-4 Divine Shield. Or sorry.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Yeah. I mean, it gets executed, but you don't really care if it gets executed because...
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it was a bit of a misplay. I think he should have attacked first. Now you point that out. Yes. Because he probably wasn't expecting the 1-4 to go on it, but so he didn't think clearly enough. But yes, that was a slight... Slide error there. Maybe he was thinking he would attack differently if it went on one of the other guys.
Maybe he's worried about... since he's gotten some damage on his opponent now, it's less likely that he's able to go Shield Slam plus Brawl. Or Brawl plus Shield Slam or something like that. Whereas you could have gone for Execute plus Brawl here. But then you can do that anyway. I guess I'm thinking kind of crazy here. But in any case, my mind's kind of wandering. But Lao Xiaobu, in any case, he's in a bit of a pickle here. Looks like he might have to just Shield Slam this twice. Which is obviously very painful.
And this is going back to what you said earlier about Brawl being so key in this match.
Right.
Like, just a Brawl here sorts this mess out, and you just then do your Control Warrior thing and dig your way back into the game. But without Brawl, you've just got this,
this horde of yeah, right here,
garbage coming at you.
That, right? I mean, it's in a parallel line with Fu Oliver's portrait there. It's all of that. It's disgusting.
It's just, what am I looking at here? Yeah.
7 damage overkill on a 6-1 minion feels very bad. And even revenge here would be pretty nice, but unfortunately unable to draw that thus far.
So 31 life, he's facing 3 turn lethal, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Which sounds okay. Really? Okay.
I guess you do it as quickly as you can before your opponent is able to draw anything, so...
Yeah, just identifying, I guess, that it doesn't really matter. If your opponent plays something big, you're probably going to lose. If he plays it on a stable board, that is.
And you have 2 get downs, so...
And it did actually speed up the clock.
Yeah, you have 2 get downs here, so your opponent... Even if your opponent plays something like this Alexstrasza, for instance, you don't really care.
Yeah. Yeah, that was actually great, because it put him to a 2-turn clock and a 3-turn clock, so it was very, very important.
So for Lao Xiaobu here, what do you do other than just concede? Because this is very difficult.
So...
I guess if you play the Grom here, you can actually take out something because the Get Down can't get procced. The Noble Sacrifice, to use the proper term.
I mean, you're still thinking that if you can draw a Brawl, you can maybe get out of this. That's what you're hoping, like, get draw a Brawl and even win it. So maybe you just Shield Maiden and Armorsmith.
I guess you do have to armor up at the very least, or else you're going to die. Even if you use the Grom here, so that wasn't an option. Yeah. So what are we looking at here? Another Mysterious Challenger, unable to be played unless he starts sacrificing minions. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. And it's currently at 24 is Lo Jia Bu, so a bit off is Fuelver. Just go face? You might just play the Mysterious Challenger to get the other secrets out of your deck so you can start drawing the things like Dr. Boom and Tyrion, which will seal out the game if ever your opponent does deal with your board.
But yeah, that's a good idea.
So yeah, it looks like he is going to go for that and going to play out this Mysterious Challenger most likely. Let's see how many secrets come out this time. We have seen
many. He's played a few from hand, yeah.
Wait, did the first Avenge get procced? I don't think so.
No, that'd be the second Avenge so and that... second Redemption?
Well, the Noble Sacrifice is still up.
Oh, so it's just the second Avenge.
Right.
Okay. Or making it too complicated, yeah.
Right. So, I mean, you can't draw cards. I don't know why Love Shovel is looking at his deck, but okay. Anyway, that's going to be it.
I think he was, he's been checking it for a couple of turns, thinking how unlucky he is that he hasn't drawn his Brawl.
15
he's got a habit that I have where you just keep checking your deck size when you're trying to desperately draw something to see what your chances are, and then when you're dead, you keep checking it to see why you were so unlucky.
Right. Well, that's going to be the Warrior taken out here. On the side of EDG, and looking at the score, I believe that's 6-5 in
6-5 to Yolo Miracle.
Right,
and Nicholas is going to have to play Rogue
against Paladin, though, which is a good matchup. So, good situation here for Lo Jia Bu. Just to let you guys know, this is last hero standing, but it's also last player standing. So they have to go through their, basically, they have to play until they lose. You can't switch them out if they lose one of their decks. And so the fact that Lo Jia Bu had Rogue waiting here to be able to go against the Paladin is really nice for him.
Yep, and we haven't seen anything different in Rogues apart from like one or two weeks where they knew they were going to play against other Rogues in the sort of basement of the Ace match. We just haven't seen any change in 14 weeks in Rogue decks. It's just, you know... the same 27, pick 3, depending how you like to build your oil rogue, and that's it.
Well, the difference is it's better against Secret Paladin, right? So that made it rise up the ranks a bit here. But yes. Anyway, what were you going to say, Shrink?
Oh, I was going to say that we actually see some different kind of rogue. I mean, just Fodder himself actually played some Raptor Rogue, and we've seen Sword playing some Aggro Rogue as well, so...
Okay.
Yeah, it comes occasionally, but I mean, there's a reason why they stopped playing those decks and it didn't continue. But yeah, in any case, this is kind of an interesting hand here from Fualver. It has nothing really to do. Looks like he's just going to not coin to anything. I guess there's nothing really to coin into. But going to save that coin potentially for Mysterious Challenger. But if... Love Jia Bu doesn't take out this 1-1 right here. He could be playing into Blessing of Kings, and then it would be playing into, you know, Coin Mysterious Challenger the following turn. But he does take it out, realizing that, you know, there could be a very clunky hand here for Fualver. So, good read by him.
Yeah. 5-6. Pretty good hands all around, again. That's what constructed decks do for you, isn't it? Bring a deck that you like that isn't Reno. Because that is this curve.
Well, so
when you've got two of everything, you just get the things you want on a regular basis. So having watched Sleepy Shaman for like 5 games, this isn't my Reno dig. This is just like, you're just realizing how nice it is to have two of everything again.
Right.
curving out nicely.
Wait, why is he... Okay. Okay, so
he's...
a question. Okay, 5-2 Divine Shield or 5-5, which is better?
I mean, I. It's close, but I always prefer the Divine Shield. You have to hit it twice.
I suppose against the Rogue, if the Rogue is able... Yeah, against the Rogue, if the Rogue is able to stabilize, then, you know, being able to take it out very easily with its hero power, which costs one mana, essentially, it might be a bit better, and now he has to deal 5 damage, which is a bit harder. Ends up being
it's a little bit different from being, like, something like a 3-2 or a 3-1, where you just want the Divine Shield and make them do two different things to it, so...
Mm-hmm.
In this case, maybe it's close.
It ended up being almost the exact same thing here, though, because I imagine that Lovejabba would have to use the Eviscerate anyway, even if it was a 5-2. But in any case, it's going to be the Mysterious Challenger hitting the board once more. The Noble Sacrifice was drawn, but that could have been drawn anyway, I suppose. So it's not the worst thing ever. And, we have the same exact 4 secrets. Lovejabba remembers what they are. Looks like he's thinking about them in his head. Not going to be any repentance, but it's going to be the competitive spirit as well as the traditional 3 that you'd see. So Lovejabba would be able to play out this this Dr. Boom and not worry about getting repentance, but there could be something like a Keeper of Aldemon, and that could slow him down a bit there.
And he's just slightly concerned about his life total as well. Really, you don't want to play this heal bot here if you possibly help it. Like, just terrible place to have to play it, and he's just double-checking, I think. He's pretty meticulous about his counting and stuff. He's just making sure that no accidents can happen here with competitive spirits and such like.
Yeah, so 11 damage on the board. Lovejabba really couldn't afford to attack there. In fact, he would have been dead if he attacked there.
So,
I mean, not on board, but with the Blessing of Kings in hand.
Effectively dead.
So if you're Fuelver, do you just Blessing of Kings one of these guys and hit the face here?
9, 10, 11...
Well, I would kill the Boom Bot and heal, hit the face with 7-7 and play the Dr. Boom.
That's a reasonable play as well. And it does put a lot of pressure on the board, especially against a Rogue, who, you know, notoriously has trouble dealing with Dr. Booms. We don't know if he runs BGH in his deck, as we see Lovejabba kind of looking at the rest of his deck right now.
It's the same magic number that he checked last time, 15.
Except he reached it a lot quicker this time. But we'll see what Fueliver goes with. Looks like he's favoring the damage and just going to go face with his 6-6. Doesn't really want to... Oh, he's actually going to clear. Interesting. Okay. So he's going to kind of half clear, but get a lot of damage to the face anyway. He doesn't want the Dr. Boom to be able to do anything crazy. And Sap wouldn't be the greatest here. We see the second heal bot come into the hand of Lovejabba. Was Lovejabba the one who played Rogue last series as well? I think he did. He did, and he did well with his double heal bot.
Last series, he did.
Yes, I think so.
And he had double heal bot, as you say. So it's likely the same deck.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we can see it's the same deck now, sorry. But they basically kept the same lineups apart from Warrior and Paladin switched, I believe. And there's a Mech Mage instead of A3s.
So, Fueliver is looking pretty upset that the buff went onto his now 9-8 Silverhand recruit, but in reality, there's no BGH and there's no SAP in Lovejabba's hand, so... he's gonna...
Yeah, it's actually not a bad thing for it to happen to him. But it happens.
In fact,
that always happens, by the way. It's like one of those always huffer things. The Avenge just goes on the biggest available minion.
And he's going to be pretty happy about this coming up here once we see this. This is actually kind of an unusual rogue hand. Typically, you don't see this many minions in hand like this. It's usually a lot of spells.
So 10, 12. And if they were watching earlier, which I'm sure they were, they will know there's a good chance of double healbot being in this deck.
Mm-hmm. Even, I mean, no matter whether there is a double healbot or whether there is a second healbot or not, you can't not hit the face again with this 9-6.
Yeah, sure. Like, you know, this is what, when you decided to do that turn when you went half and half, you decided at that point that's the last trade you're making.
Right.
You now have to just smash in the face the rest of this game.
So, a little apprehensive here is Fueliver. He's thinking about playing the Dr. Boom, but, I mean, he probably thinks that there might be some sort of big Blade Flare that could come out and ruin his day, which would be kind of annoying for Oliver here, particularly if he doesn't take out this heal bot, because that would be able to take out, you know, something like, or take out the defender here, the noble sacrifice.
And he did have an alternative in wasting some mana, but Sludge Belcher to protect your 9/6 is also something that definitely merits consideration. But the thing with Dr. Boom is its protection against Blade Flurry as well, with the Boom Bots and so on and so on.
Because it just kills the face, right?
Because it just kills your opponent, which is always a strong thing to do.
And this is an impossible situation for Love Shabu. He was reaching for that Azure Drake, but what does that really give you? You can't, even if you drop Blade Flurry, you can't clear the board with it. If you sprint, first of all, you're overdrawing. So not to speak of the fact that you wouldn't have any mana. And, I mean, Voliver's got to look at this and say, really, just Azure Drake in this situation? This is awesome.
Yeah. Play another one, please. You have an extra mana. Here you go.
I'll give you Tomb Pillager.
So that's going to be...
wow.
Win for Voliver.
Voliver takes out Love Jabu here, and that's going to be, what, 7?
7-5.
Yeah, 7-5 in favor of Yolo Miracle. And they are down to their last player. Speaking of EDG, oh, speaking of both teams, actually, Yolo Miracle is one player kill away from advancing to the finals, whereas EDG is down to the last player and need to basically kill the rest of the players of Yolo Miracle with that player. And that's going to be Yin
Yang.
Yin Yang, yeah.
And he's going to have
Priest and something else.
And Shaman.
Oh, yes, Shaman, yeah.
Priest and Shaman. So, I talked a bit before we were talking.
Sorry, a bit of drama. I like my drama.
Sorry, I was looking down on the sheet, and I look up, and Rosicky has that face. But,
like, why did you lose, man? I gave him my all out there.
Wait, but he didn't lose. He won.
Okay, yeah. So, I don't know what's happening here. Why did you win, man?
Rosicky is, I don't know what's going on with Rosicky. And in case you guys missed it, because it happened really quick, Rosicky just went up and lost 0-2, and he was really upset the entire time, putting his head down and everything. And he is, in our subjective opinion, and actually just objectively by the stats as well, their weakest player, kind of by far. They have three really strong players, and another player actually who isn't here is very strong as well. And it was just really bizarre to see him do that.
Like, he gave up from about turn 2 in his first game, then like play badly or horribly or anything, but he just didn't look like he wanted to be playing Hearthstone at that point. He was on tilt before he started almost.
Yeah, the worst body language. But in any case, EDG, not Yolo Miracle, are the ones in danger, mostly because of the way that Sleepy Shaman picked up the slack for Rosicky and, you know, performed admirably. But I mean, Fuolver as well, he's done pretty well here. I think, what is Fuolver now, 2-1?
Fuolver is now 2-1, yes.
Right, so going to be Yin Yang, EDG's last player, and I was going to mention this before Rosicky kind of had a hissy fit there, but Priest and Shaman, completely polar opposite decks, and it worked before because, or in their previous match against Tong Fu, because if you win with one of the decks and your opponent's trying to counter that deck, then they can't really counter both Priest and Shaman since they're so polar opposite, but in this case he needs to all kill his entire opponent, so this is where the strategy might backfire.
And Fuolver has mage left after the paladin loses, if the paladin loses, so if it comes to that, there's a mage to deal with, and that's just too hard to predict. That could be anything. So
right,
he might be freeze mage, because judging from the regular season, we did see a lot of freeze mage from Robin, and actually freeze mage are not bad against both the priest and shaman.
And he did choose not to put it into the control warrior as opposed to the other two decks, so that also points to there being a good chance it's freeze mage.
He did play freeze mage earlier today as well. He might be tired of playing freeze mage, I'm not sure, but he looks pretty spry there. the player
he doesn't look like a man who's played like 17 games of Hearthstone competitively in two different studios. Today. Pretty good going.
I suspect foul play. I think he's on performance enhancing drugs.
Shoe on head. So,
all right. So we're going to see the priest come out here, and this isn't completely one-sided. The secret paladin is capable of winning, but the priest has a lot of options to deal with the paladin. And
it can take its time, the priest in this match. Like, you don't have to win it early as a priest. You can clear the board, and the paladin keeps coming along. You can just keep clearing it, and you can take this very, very deep into the decks.
Yeah, and he got the coin, and he got the pyromancer, which is really good for him.
Yeah, whenever you're playing as a control deck, you want to go second, because you want as many options as possible. Obviously, if you're going second, you go against a deck that has one drop on turn one and two drop on turn two. That can be problematic, but typically they don't have a perfect hand there in that situation. And as the control, you just want as much stuff to be able to combat your opponent's board.
Interesting decision to make here straight away. I mean, there's the opportunity just Velen's chosen this thing, clear the Secret Keeper, and just sit there with this huge Northshire Cleric.
Yeah, and looks like he is going to go for that. Typically, there's not a quality run in Secret Paladin, and not many owls either. It's one or the other, and sometimes neither.
And then next turn, he can play the Pyromancer and heal the Cleric, draw a card, proc the shield, kill a guy.
Wow, and that's a circle. Oh my goodness.
That's a circle, just in case he needed anything more crazy, yeah.
Oh my god. How do you do this? This is like blowing my mind right now.
I think... Well, he'll show us.
Oh, he's gonna just do it. He's just gonna do it this way, actually. So that's actually pretty nice as well. I get a 3-7 and a 4-7. And draw two cards at the same time.
Protect your pyromancer, still keep your heal. I mean, however you wanted to do that wasn't bad. It may even be personal taste. Sometimes those decisions just come down to how you see it.
Mm-hmm. So, Blessing Follower's like, this is my broken thing. Let me just show you. And puts the Blessing Kings up. But immediately going to get death by Inyan. And this is working out really well for him.
Yeah. This game likes to make a liar of the casters, doesn't it? It's like, this isn't as like one-sided as you think it is. Bosh, 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 4-7-2-3.
I mean, all your things are dead. Come on, yeah, Northshire Cleric into Coin Valens, into Blademaster, into Circle. And he had the death. And he had the death once Fowler had
the Blessing. It's just funny how the game loves to mock the casters. The second you say anything insightful, it's like, no, that's not going to happen.
Oh my god.
There's a Justicar, just in case you need a 4 life a turn. And
do you play the Shrinkmeister or the Pyromancer? I guess the Pyromancer is more valuable going forward.
I keep the Pyromancer for muster for later or for for whatever. For things.
For things that could happen.
There's no need to keep the Shrink here. You can, but...
Look at this hand. Look at this hand from Follower. I mean, it's not that bad if you already had a board, but he has no board. He's facing down a 4-7, a 3-2. He's like, I have a Knife Juggler and a Haunted Creeper.
I just hope you haven't got Justicon and Tomb. I'll be fine.
He's thinking about playing the Contra Creation. That's how a dire situation he's in.
Wow.
And... if you're Inyan, do you just throw out this Justicar here, or do you, apologies for the bit of lag here.
But... I think I throw it out. Yeah. Do you even need to?
I mean, the problem with not throwing it out is that you're not doing anything else, so I guess, you just gonna go ahead and deal with it. And now that your opponent's just attacked...
You can flash heal your guy now, though. Yeah. Yeah, I just like this.
Obviously, Ian had a lot of time to think about that, but he did it pretty immediately. I suppose he values his board more than healing. And you don't need to play the Justicar. It's not like you're playing Warrior.
Yeah, and the Flash Heal is something that, in this matchup, isn't going to save your face. It's not going to kill your opponent, particularly. Mm-hmm. So it's got no real use. So healing a Blade Master for 5, the full amount, seems like as good a use you're going to get out. I quite like that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But he is playing quickly, by the way. That is a good spot. He's been playing very considered and slowly for the last run. And then today, now he's playing a bit quicker. Like this morning, he was playing a lot slower than this.
Right.
Which is sometimes a sign of fatigue when players start speeding up.
What do you think about not playing the Northshire here? I mean, I feel like the only way that Fowler gets back in this game is via the Divine Favor, if he has in this deck.
Oh, that's a good call.
You could just throw out the Northshire Cleric right now and not really worry about it.
I wouldn't have thrown it out there because I'd have forgotten about Divine Favor, but I think we've seen. No, in fairness, I think we've seen enough of the deck from Fowler over the last two games that there's probably not Divine Favors in there. As he ripped one off the top, surely next turn now. But
Looks like
he went pretty deep into the deck in the game against the Warrior.
Looks like he feels like it doesn't really matter how many cards his opponent draws. As long as he draws enough cards himself, he is going to have enough answers over the long run. So
yeah.
Not really worrying about it. Just getting as many cards as possible. And
this is actually the situation I was talking about earlier when I said about Divine Favor against Control doesn't always work out that way. It's like...
This is a bit extreme, though. This is a bit extreme.
Yeah, this is the situation I did mean, though. It's like sometimes it just could be a different card.
Usually what you're looking for as the aggro deck, though, is you throw your hand or throw everything onto the field and you get ahead that way, but you're running out of steam and then you Divine Favor. Not when already Divine.
Yeah, it continues to snowball, right?
Exactly.
But when you get into this situation, you Divine Favor, it doesn't do what it looks like it does.
Yeah, exactly.
And this is game now when you play Justicar.
Yeah, Justicar, just heal everything. I mean, even if somehow Fallover gets the ward back, it will take so long to kill Enion that he will draw something to be able to
Yeah, I mean, he needs Mysterious Challenger into Boom, into Tyrion to even get this level.
Exactly. Even,
and he'll be six cards behind.
I think he would still be behind. I think he would still lose afterward, but...
Yeah, I think he would still lose afterwards. Just to even get in the game, I think that's what he needs, that sequence.
Right.
He's just literally going through the motions here, too.
I guess he's just trying to get as much information as possible.
Yeah, information.
He did see the Justicar, so there's that.
And...
Seeing the Thought Steal now. I mean, Enion, I think he's giving away too much. I mean, look at Fallover. Fallover
priest.
Yeah, Capet Spirit. I mean, look at Fallover. He just, cracked his head. He's like, okay, whatever. I've already lost this game. But he got the information. He knows his opponent has Justicar and Thought Steal, and that's pretty valuable.
Yeah, definitely. And... Okay.
So and he's just saying, I think he's just kind of play acting almost. He's like, yeah, I'm still in this game. Absolutely. Play more stuff that I can, learn more about your deck about.
That'll do. Not that it teaches me anything, but yeah. Hey, Priest played Light Bomb, Newsflash.
Yeah, so nothing in his hand right here. I guess second flash heal is, I mean, usually you play two flash heals if you're going to play one. But it could be something, I suppose.
But you might not.
But it looks like we have Lethal on board here for Enion. So no more information for Fualver. That's going to be game for Enion. He's going to bring it to 7-6. Still in favor of Yolo Miracle, but good on them to be able to get that win there.
And we're going to see Fualver's Mage next up.
And if it is Freeze Mage, it is a pretty good situation for them because it's definitely favored against the Priest. Though, double Flash Heal plus Justicar. It's
quite a lot of burst though, I guess.
Yeah, it's burst, but it's also burst heal,
Both sides, yeah. So you can kill them through the block, but also you can stop them Alexstrasa-ing for the win.
Yeah, I mean, they Alexstrasa you death, you heal yourself, you flash heal for, 6 mana total, and all of a sudden you're back up at 24 health. So that could be something that could definitely make a situation here. In any case, we are going to see that Freeze Mage, and this is going to be a very involved game. Obviously, this used to be a matchup where you just go, okay, the Freeze Mage is very, very favored, but that Flash Heal, that Justicar makes a huge difference here, so this is going to be really complicated for both players.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, well, let's watch them do that then.
First you're going to draw cards. That's what you're going to do first.
Yeah,
and Fualver doesn't care about giving his opponent cards, it seems.
I was just
going
to say, he doesn't care about giving his opponent cards, actually a relevant thing there. Do you want to get your Deathlord killed or not in this situation? To try and get the mage to maybe drop an Alexstrasa accidentally onto the table?
But you don't have death.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Not necessarily straight away, but...
Oh, yeah, you do want to have something substantial like that drop, but... you don't have the way to deal with it, so if that guy just runs amok, you could be in trouble.
Yeah, you just get hit by 4 turns for Alexstrasa and turns 2-5 and lose that way would be kind of entertaining.
It's like, wait a second, if Alexstrasa hits you twice, that's more than 15 damage. Wait a second.
He's got to do 30, though.
You can't do... Well, I mean, there's going to be burn in the deck, but... anyway, enough about that. So there's going to be more cards drawn here. Looks like he's going to be protecting his Deathlord here, which is kind of interesting. But, drawing more cards is Enion. So is Fualver. Goes up to 9, so not going to overdraw here. Imagine he just wants to play out this Mad Scientist as quickly as possible. I mean, obviously you're going to do that in any matchup, but in particular this matchup where your opponent could, Cabal it later on in the game.
Yep, so priest. Does he go full North Shore?
Yeah, that would be funny. That would be kind of interesting here. I think he draws
too many cards, which is probably too many, but he can draw as many cards as he wants to draw here, being the point.
Mm-hmm.
He's got control over how many cards he draws. Entomb.
Looks like he's applying damage to face here, is Inyan.
Yeah, very interesting that every point of damage he's decided is really important.
There really isn't too much reason to deal with these guys on the board. I mean, if you're getting a fireball of your opponent, it's kind of a win for you. If he does decide to commit it to this Deathlord.
Yeah, and he's seen a flash heal, right? So he's not going to get caught out by that.
You mean Fulver?
Yeah, Fulver saw one of the flash heals last game, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did see the flash heal. But, yeah, for Inyan, I think he's perfectly fine with a fireball coming down on this Deathlord. Yep. Inyan could use flash heal to deal with an Alexstrasza, for instance. Actually, just use the Entomb, huh? But,
yeah, he's fine now. Like, now he'll actually be wanting to take the gamble that an Alexstrasza comes off it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas previously, he would have been slightly worried that maybe it gets destroyed. So I assume he'll actually start healing the Blade Master and not the Death Lord now.
Do you think Fulver is looking to win via fatigue here? I mean, he's drawing a lot of cards himself, obviously, but I mean, he knows that Inyan can just heal and draw cards here.
It's probably on his mind, right?
Mm-hmm.
I guess he won't have decided for another turn or two, but he probably doesn't mind being behind on cards because these cards aren't going to, or in his mind, probably won't punish him in a hurry. He should be able to, I mean, at the moment he can't clear them, but he should be able to clear them at will pretty much down the line. Maybe
assuming
it's just a huge game of chicken going on.
Well, I mean, Inyan can clear a Doomsayer with Akanai Flash Shield plus Heal. So that's kind of a risky play if whoever thinks that he can just clear with Freeze plus Doomsayer later on in the game.
Yeah, obviously everything's out of Flamestrike range already.
Mm-hmm.
So he probably...
Alright, so Frost Nova and Ice Barrier comes out. Ice Barrier, obviously you want to kind of develop it early so that you get the value out of that. But the Frost Nova is very viable. He does have a second one in hand. but that's something that's really... I keep saying this, but it's very valuable. It's very cheap. It's one of your most valuable freezes that you have in your deck. But looks like Inyan just passes it back, doesn't do anything, and doesn't even heal. Doesn't want an extra card because he's going to overdraw.
Yeah.
And now the Blizzard comes down. So, I mean, basically the Blizzard is nice for clearing minions sometimes, but for the most part, you want the cheaper freeze on your opponent.
And he's just pacing his draws again. This is going to make him overdraw next turn, is it?
It would if he didn't else play turn. Something else. Yeah. So he's going to put out the Pyromancer.
It's fine. And this board's still pretty menacing. Probably merits a Flame Strike now. But the reluctance to kill this Death Lord must be telling Yin-Yang that the Alexstrasza isn't in hand yet.
Yeah, I think maybe Fulver, he's desperately drawing cards for that reason. He wants to get the Alexstrasza in hand beforehand, and then clear it, and then maybe play for Fatigue. I mean, he could still win Fatigue. This game is actually really crazy. You typically don't see, you know, Freeze Maze versus Control Freeze go to Fatigue, but it could definitely be the case here.
Like, losing your Death Lord and getting your Alexstrasza entombed might be really good win condition for the Priest.
Right.
Which is just the sort of thing you don't want to think about particularly hard, but yeah, it makes a lot of sense that would actually be a win condition for the Priest, not for the Mage, which is it's pretty silly.
So, Inyan was able to use Flash Heal, or not Flash Heal, a Circle of Healing there to heal his board back up, and he didn't draw a ton of cards. Do you think that might have been a bit of a mistake there by Fulver going for the Flame Strike? Because obviously that's a very valuable, you know, clear that he has, and he kind of helped his opponent there.
I guess he's thinking that there aren't many things that Flamestrike actually kills in this deck. everything has 5 toughness or more.
They're too healthy.
like, not just counting the board, but everything has 5 toughness or more, apart from a couple of Nautia Clerics. We haven't seen a Curator, but something like that might turn up. There really isn't that much, unless you've got Blood Mage, which you want to save for your combo.
By the way,
maybe he just decided, let's just use it.
Yeah, by the way, this is the first piece of burn that we've seen in this entire game for Fallover that ice lands and doesn't even burn unless you freeze something first.
That's really interesting, especially as we have seen two frost novas, which sort of
he's gotten all of the freeze and everything. But looks like he's gonna draw more cards here. Needs to play actually a lot of cards out to prevent his opponent from forcing him to overdraw.
Yeah, we just want to.
So it goes on to 7, which is the magic number here. Doesn't really matter if his opponent is that. So it's gonna just kill it out. Is Enyon looks like. Picks up a death here, which is kind of nice, just to have a cheap removal. I mean, obviously, he could have entombed anything if he wanted. Really desperate situation, he could have used a light bomb, but just having that really cheap removal is really nice.
And we are in that little twilight zone that happens in this matchup sometimes, where nobody's touching the Death Lord. We're not healing the Death Lord. We're not trying to kill the Death Lord. The Death Lord's just being to a turn. It's like Curse of...
He's Switzerland. No one wants to just leave him alone.
Exactly. He's Switzerland. He's acting like a Curse of a Firm in Switzerland. He's just this guy who's just doing his thing.
All right. So we're going to have Thorsten hit the board here and going to discount a few things, quite a few things in the hand of Fallover here. Going to get a 1-mana Frostwold, a 0-mana Icelands, you know, some other stuff in there as well.
Suicide the Death Lord here?
You,
or do you read it that he's just drawn the Alex Straza, so you can't suicide your Death Lord now?
I suppose.
You think with the Thorsten hitting the board, maybe you're thinking, oh damn, he's drawn the Alex Straza, I won't go for that play anymore.
Yeah, I mean that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do. You don't really need to give it up right now.
If you can see the hand, you go for it immediately, right? You go like, we've got about a 1 in 4 of hitting this Alex.
Actually, no. The more I think, well, to be fair, you can't actually sacrifice it. It doesn't actually die, but. I do see what you're saying, and I think you would... I mean, you have so much removal in hand, I don't see how you wouldn't do it, honestly. Because
you can deal with the Alex, you can even entomb the Alex.
Eventually, this Death Lord's not going to get anything. But maybe he feels like this Death Lord's going to be invincible and just never die this game, and then he's just going to win with it.
Oh yeah, maybe he just feels that the good card's already in the hand, so what's the point?
Right. Doomsayer hitting
it's not invincible now.
Interesting. So, Fallover's banking on... He clears the board here.
He's actually going to burn him out without the Alex, is his plan.
Right.
He's going to set up a block, shoot you with fireballs twice, you do nothing, shoot with fireballs twice, and some more damage from somewhere.
So this is kind of cool, playing this out and just making it so that, you know, Enyon's board gets cleared and you have a ton of time to play out these fireballs, and that's why you played the Doomsayer here. On the side of Enyon, can you clear both of these? This is why the death is really important, because it's so cheap. He actually can. He can go for the death plus Akanai Flash Heal.
Oh, yeah.
There's that too. Okay, maybe you just do that. Death plus Entomb. That's a bit easier. So just Entomb the Doomsayer here. But that leaves him without the ability to clear Alexstrasza unless he uses
Yeah, it wasn't immediately obvious, because you'd rather entomb the Alexstrasza. That's why we're both like looking at other ways to do it first.
Mm-hmm.
He has also got a lot of damage in hand, you realize.
Enyon?
Yeah.
Right, but he has to get through a block. He has to get through 2 blocks.
He can proc block, but he's going to die to all this. Well, maybe he doesn't, because of double heal your face.
I mean, hey, you do have double flash heal, but there's a lot of damage in Fallover's hand right now. There's the Entomb, but this is actually really unfortunate for Enyon that he hasn't drawn the Justicar.
Yeah, that would be such a big difference right now. And unfortunately for him, they're not being able to proc the block because of the fact he had to not die.
Right.
And he knows about the fireballs, so obviously he didn't even have to consider taking the risk. He still looks in terrible shape. Like you say, if the Justicar comes off the top, and he can heal for 6, that might be something.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
But looking from Fulver's point of view as well, do you keep fireballing the face? Because you don't have enough damage, honestly.
12, 18...
Also, do you play
fireball for 14 this turn because of the Blood Mage.
Right, do you play the Blood Mage, though? Because you could get it stolen by the Cabal. And card draw is pretty important for Enyon, too.
That would be nasty. I think if you go for Lethal, your Blood Mage next turn. Are you adding it up? So it's 26. You've only got 3 fireballs. You're only 18.
Mm-hmm.
Awkward
time. He has another fireball in his deck, by the way. I think, other than the fireball that is discounted in his hand. All the fireballs he shot so far are Antonite's fireballs, so I think he's one more and he has the Frostbolt and Ice Lance. Not sure if he has a Pyro Blast as well, but also, obviously that's a big deal if he can draw into that. Ineon is looking a bit stressed here, doesn't really know what to do. But I think his best opportunity here is to steal out this Blood Mage and heal himself. Actually, the big problem with that though is that he might not be able to play Justicar if he ever draws it.
Yeah, against Freeze Mage, it's often a mistake to fill your board up, right?
He could throw away his slime onto the Mad Scientist.
Yeah.
You throw away your slime, you still proc your opponent at 2, which is fine. No, you proc, like him this, up, you proc him at 1, yeah, no matter what, but...
Don't like it so much now.
He's actually... Why I don't really like taking the Scientist, because that hurts your opponent... Wait, does it
Unless mean, he's go fatigue.
Oh, maybe he's worried about his opponent not having... Maybe he just wants his opponent not to have an Ice Block. Yeah, okay, so we can see both hands. And we know that there's Ice Block in hand for Fualver, but maybe Yinyan was
of
just...
Of course, yeah, that makes obvious sense now you say it, yes.
Yeah, so he didn't want his opponent to not to get Ice Block there.
Yeah. Yeah, like you say, so it's always as cast as you just see the other hand and you forget they can't... Especially at the end of sort of a day of casting as well.
And is that going to be it? Frostbolt? No, not enough mana. Did he emote? Did he emote preemptively? this is actually really interesting. Does he have a way to win? So he has 6, 13... He should have enough.
Over two
turns, I mean. Because he can't...
But he's going to be fatigued to death.
Oh! But the fact that he's being so demonstrative right now... That could give away to Yinyan. Maybe Yinyan didn't... Well, he just checked his card. Never mind. Just kidding. He just checked the deck size of Yinyan. But, so it looked like Fualver was going to win, but now it looks like Yinyan's going to win because of the fact
that... Because he's played the Acolyte.
Right. Awesome. So, wow.
And in case he's going to miss it, he can hear Fualver choking to death in the corner behind him.
Exactly.
Just in case he didn't see him.
Oh my goodness, so that is going
to
be...
The Ghost of Raziski comes to play.
And Yinyan doesn't even hit the Acolyte twice, he just says, I'm going to kill him like a baller. And pass the turn over him, and Yinyan takes the game with his Priest. Fualver's out, we are down to our last two aces here, it's tied 7-7.
7-7, and wow. That's... You what about the fatigue earlier, but playing that Acolyte and then... Because can they see each other? They probably can, out the corner of their eyes there.
Right. I mean, but we saw Ineon there. He was looking at the deck, and he looked pretty confident the entire time. So, I don't know. This is just a crazy game. I mean, obviously we were a bit subdued casting that, but we can't just be yelling that entire time. This is impossible, right? And especially since we've been casting all day. But make no mistake, that game was pretty crazy.
Yeah, there was a lot going on there, and... To be fair, the priest never really looked like he was winning. He always looked like he knew what he was doing.
Right.
And he was playing it correctly and a lot of clever plays, but including stealing the scientist, which we both sort of not worked out. did he never draw an Alex Raza at all? Was it the bottom card?
No, he didn't. Yeah, it was the last card, that's right. It was the last card. It was on the right side of his hand as he lost there. And but neither did Yinyan ever pick up the Justicar, so it goes both ways there. And it's going to be Robin, our last player here. I would say he's around Fualver's level. I would say Sleepy Shaman is the best player on Yolo Miracle, but Robin definitely very experienced, very...
Robin's also getting better.
Yeah.
He qualified for the last 16 of the Star Series, the Star Ladder I-League thing recently, which is played next month, I believe.
Yeah,
or later this month. And he's been winning things. So yeah, him and Fualver are definitely going. Him and Yinyan are going to be a really good match. I think Robin's possibly a little bit better, but I mean, there's nothing in it at this level. They're all.
It's nice when you play games for a living to be winning things, you know. But
Actually, Robin was a guy who led Yolo Miracle to the NEL victory last time, so he's looking to do the same.
Because there were previous leagues to this, they just weren't the Team Story League. Right?
Yeah, but this is the kind of reincarnation of the NEL from before.
And this is interesting because it's been the meme all the way through the league that Shaymin versus Shaymin is always the last game because they're so bad. And suddenly Shaymin became playable, and it might end up as Shaymin versus Shaymin in the last hero standing as the last game. That'd be
we could amazing. Have a Shamanov.
Wow, every
our
time.
Our famous Russian composer, Shamanov. But it looks like Robin's turned to a chicken as well. That's, and Inyan's turned to a chair. But okay, we're fixing the cameras
chicken
here.
A chair sounds like some poker phrase, I'm sure.
Interesting interesting that Robin didn't go for the warrior. I was a bit worried about losing a fatigue battle potentially with the mage. Obviously because of things like Thought Steal and Tune, that does make the priest deck pretty thick.
Yeah, it's a different matchup to what it used to be, where the warrior used to just win for the meme that the priest couldn't go above 30, right?
Right.
But now the priest can steal your things and kill you with them.
Yeah, I mean, it could just be Patron Warrior, which be not that great.
Yeah. Right, right, right. Okay. Patron Warrior would be a disaster, yeah.
Good cool shrink.
Oh!
Inyan going directly for the Blademaster Circle of Healing here.
Yeah, I don't think you mess around when you're trying to deal with a Shaman deck. If you can survive 5 turns on about 18 life or more, you're usually well set. That doesn't happen very often, by the way. But if you can do that, then you're usually in fairly good shape.
Wow, 5 is huge here. So now you can take this out with the Abusive Sergeant, which is a big deal. But yeah. I mean, I was just considering the fact that Inyan can't now use...
He's not coin. He can coin Lightning Bolt or coin Rock Biter as well.
Right, and he's not going to be able to use the Doomhammer next turn anyway.
Yeah, so it might be a good time to just go Coin Lightning Bolt, then kind of miss a turn whilst hitting someone for 6 in the face.
Right, and you perfectly have the right amount of mana to just totem next turn anyway, because you're Overloader for 2.
Mm-hmm.
And
so that's definitely a consideration.
Right, and that Beast of Sarchan, there's a good chance that it gets more damage than 3 overall to the face. But looks
like you get 2 this turn and 2 next turn a lot of the time, so... That's the play he's going for.
So, another big minion hitting the field here. Got rid of a 4-7, now there's a 3-7. But,
yeah. Can you afford to not deal with it?
You could run Taunt Totem.
I mean...
That's what Sleepy Shaman would have done.
Sleepy Shaman would have gotten the Taunt Totem, absolutely. So Sludge Buster hitting the field here, and I mean there is the mana to go for Doomhammer. You can actually clear the board here, but or not clear the board, clear the Sludge Buster, excuse me. But there's double Flash Heal in hand, which is really nice to have if you're just trying to live.
Yeah, especially when you've got something that draws you more cards while you do it.
Bit of a misplay here by Robin. He took 2 extra damage for no reason.
Yeah.
But
it's actually a good draw as well at this point.
Inyan gonna go ahead and just draw some cards here and use double Flash Heal here. Could have maybe saved it, especially because it's so cheap. You could use it with Akanai or something to kill something that's pretty dangerous, but I suppose, you know, his North Shire will do the trick here. A lot of damage in the hand of Robin, though. I mean, he could still just do this 24 here. I guess the only problem is he's dealing with a 3-5 on board, so he is on a clock.
Yeah, and it's a 3-5 that draws more cards as well in a deck that is very good at using those cards to opt on.
Oh,
that is an Earth Shock. But maybe he might want to use it for Death Lord or something.
He could Lava Shock, Earth Shock, and Rock Rider.
Yeah, I think he's actually just going to...
He could clear the North Shire as well, because once he clears this, it looks like he's going to go both Fates. He does have a ton of Bursts in hand. And he has an Earthshock as well to get rid of any sort of taunt. So he did think about it for a while, so we'll give him credit there, because sometimes players that go about it too quickly. So he thought it through, realized he had a lot of damage, he has Earthshock for anything that comes through, so this Doomhammer is definitely getting through. So in the end, I think it might have been the correct play here. I don't think he's going to go for the Feral Spirit. Does he have enough damage right now? I think he just does, doesn't he?
I'm leaving the counting to...
He needs to roll for 5. He needs to roll for 5, so it's a 50-50 chance that he wins the game right now. He's already seen 2 Flash Heals, and Justicar only healed... Okay, it's going to just play it last then. Okay, here we go. He's taking off his headset, Just a bit premature. It rolls for six there, and Robin is able to take that game.
You will see that finish end turn bottom turn into a stays yellow instead of turning into green. So you know it as long as you play it. You don't have to see the animation. So
right, but we didn't see it because we weren't on his on. His But the funny thing was that he started taking off his headset because that's usually what you do during the regular season. If you won the game, you take off your headset, you go back to your team, and you celebrate. But you can see he's so nervous, kind of jittery. I mean, maybe not nervous, but he's like so amped up for this game right now that he's ready to just take off his headset, run back. But he's like, oh, wait, I gotta stay here for a little bit longer.
So, Shamanov.
Shamanov, nice. We got Shamanov. Who is the best Russian composer? And we'll take this.
So this has gone from who can accidentally draw some damage, like 12 weeks ago, to who doesn't draw damage now.
Right. So looking at the hands right here, Doomhammer is in the hand of Robin, but I mean, Enion's got all the minions, and that's really what you want.
Yeah, because they're the repeated sources of damage, so. They give you so much more options in terms of dealing the damage. You put it where you want, so much more easy.
Crackle's kind
of
nice, though. Hopefully it rolls higher for him. Rolls a 5. Robin is good at this game, guys. Robin is good at this game. Rolls a 6 the game before, rolls a 5 here. Obviously it was a 3 and 4 chance, but going to be an intentional knowledge coming out as well, so that's kind of nice. So, I mean, despite what we just said, you know, 2 seconds ago that with Enion probably having the better hand, I mean, Robin not doing too bad right here, right now.
Yeah, and this matchup changes so quickly because you know, ancestral knowledge or just a good top deck, and suddenly every single card has to be evaluated differently.
Huh. Lava Shock picked up here. He could actually just clear the board and play Leprenome as well, which is kind of nice. Unfortunately, he can't clear the overload of the Lightning Bolt that he would use for next turn as well, so he would be stuck out of playing the Doomhammer. But it's kind of worth it to clear the board here, not have to deal with this stuff.
Yeah, it feels like you want this out of the way. Also feels like, whilst Doomhammer is really good, it's not absolutely essential in this matchup like it might be against some of the control decks where you have to just hit your opponent in the face to finish them off.
You saw Enion sit there, just reach for his Knife Juggler, and he's like, oh no, Leprenome, really? And unfortunately, he's going to have to play it regardless, because otherwise he's going to take too much damage from this little guy.
Yep.
Ooh, Argent Horus Rider. Everything has been just... Ever since the beginning of this game, when Enion had the better hand, Robin has just... every single draw has been so good for him. And by the way, he's on match point, so every single draw that goes well for him is absolutely devastating for Enion. Misses the first match as Enion. Hits one, okay.
The winners of this will be playing Celestial in tomorrow's final. Celestial winning the league and getting a bye there. So this is really important, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Robin taking 5 damage to the face to get more damage to his opponent's face. Or it looks like he's going to just clear the board, but really wants that board control here. I mean, it is pretty important.
Especially with those totems, because if you leave that one up, there's a 50-50. The other one's going to be a taunt, or it's going to be spell damage anyway.
This is a tough decision here. Do you go for the healing? Do you go for the mage, which is very good at pinging off little things from your opponent's side? I think you go for mage, yeah. It's really, you know...
No, that's healing. He's going for the healing, I think.
I mean, not mage, for the priest, I meant. That's, yeah. My brain is mixed up, but I thought of the healing and I said mage, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
but
it's just been that sort of day.
Doomhammer is absolutely huge here. Ancestral Knowledge first. Second Doomhammer! Oh my goodness, this is absolutely insane. He can go for 16 right now. Looks like he's just going to go for 10 and go for a hero power, it looks like. And make his opponent kind of deal with it, but this could be over the next turn, guys. So... Although he's on 6 mana next turn, so there is that.
Oh.
Oh. So... Wow. Now maybe he wishes he had gone for it.
I know, right? He would have had lethal, actually. Because his opponent would have been 6 mana.
Probably a misplay, but it's not exactly the easiest misplay to spot at the end of the game. He's had a long day as well. He's played as well today, hasn't he? Was he playing early in Gold Series, or was it just for Oliver?
It was for Oliver and Love CX.
And Love CX.
who was also on Yolo Miracle.
Yeah, who chose to sit out because he wanted to watch Wojcicki play.
And by the way, there's a lot of damage in Enion side too as well. So obviously we're kind of fixated on if Robin can finish out this game, but Enion, I mean, he has 13 damage in his hand.
Yes,
spell damage totem is not going to help too much. But
I think he's spending ages trying to work out what he can do with the owl here. Can I use this owl and the rock biter to get through and win? And I can't, and why can't I?
Why can't
play my own taunt?
I think you kind of have to go for the owl plus the rock biter now. I guess you could go for the feral spirit just to get in the way.
Yeah.
Feral spirit plus use the rock biter to clear out both sides. Looks like it's just going to use his face to clear out one here. And then use the owl plus the rock butter. He's going to be on 7 mana next turn.
So that's 2. He gets to unlock as well, right? So
no,
he's got lava. 5.
He doesn't have lava shock. He has
10.
Lava burst.
I can see 10. With the owl.
Well, he can owl and then rock butter hat, and he has 10.
Without it, right?
Yeah, he has 15 with the owl, rock butter, plus lava burst. But there could be healing here from Enion. He's gonna heal the wolf, but there's an owl, and I think that's game. Owl, I think he has enough mana, right?
He can rock biter double lava burst.
But he's gonna go for the owl, gonna put the rock biter in hand, gonna hit for 10, and then lava burst of face, and Yolo Miracle is going to go to the finals and face off against Team Celestial for the championship of Hearthstone Team Story.
Awesome stuff there, and so it's actually playing out according to the seedings so far today. Edward winning the first game, and then Yolo Miracle taking this. And so they will be playing Celestial tomorrow, and I don't know what their record against Celestial is. Are they the team that beat Celestial twice?
No, that's the World Elite.
It was World Elite to beat them twice. So yeah, so Celestial will be big favourites. And
I mean, Celestial absolutely dominated the regular season. They were 30
games
over
500. Yeah, they just destroyed everybody but World Elite.
They sealed up the number one seed with like 2 weeks left to go in the season. And by sealing up means it was impossible for anyone to ever catch them with 2 weeks left, which is absolutely crazy. So it's going to be an uphill battle for Yolo Miracle, but it's only one match. You know, they don't have to make up all the room in the standings that they were behind. All they have to do is beat them one time in one best of 17. That's going to be tomorrow.
Played this format. Celestial have probably never played a best of 17 or whatever we've been casting
well,
all day.
To be fair, EDG had just played a best of 17 and they lost to Yolo Miracle. So there
fair,
is that.
But they haven't had time to process that. So
that's true.
But yeah, it's going to be really interesting to see because World Elite Yolo Miracle finished a decent second in the end. It was only sort of a couple of points, but it was enough. They were up there all of the last half of the season, and they were good for second place, I felt. As we see Callum's favourite trophy there in its box.
The Murloc trophy on the right side there. But, yeah, I mean, that is going to be Yolo Miracle going to the finals. They're going to be a best of 17 tomorrow. It's going to be at 8 Chinese time, and it is currently 12:15 a.m. Chinese time, that being midnight-ish. So, basically 20 hours from now?
Yeah, 20 hours from now. 4 hours before now, tomorrow.
Right.
Same thing.
So. Before that, I will be casting the... before the actual finals, there's going to be some sort of short match. It's going to be Alliance versus Horde or something like that. So if you want to check that out, are we casting that?
Not that I know of.
I mean, the whole point of me casting the Gold Series on my channel was to just have the ability to, you know, spread things out. But maybe I will have. Maybe I can just do it on HSCN if no one's going to be doing that cast.
Yeah, that might be good. I was only prepared for one tomorrow. While I don't mind casting a lot of Hearthstone, I'm ready to collapse after 8 hours. I'm sure you are too, so.
Right, it is 1:15 here in Japan, but. In any case, I guess just follow us on Twitter. We'll let you know what happens. We'll follow this channel as well. Just check back here regular, check our Twitters, and we'll let you know what we'll be casting. I will definitely be casting Gold Series Group C, and it's been really awesome so far. The format of that has been Conquest Best of 5 with one ban, which is really cool to see. And we've actually seen three Yolo Miracle players play in that already, which is another story altogether. But
and they do the whole group in one session, right?
So you yes, get to five see Best of 5s, exactly. Nice. Except for D and E, which for some reason they split up, I guess for time constraints. But I will be casting that tomorrow, I guess today, if you consider it already being today. But it will be, let's see, 12 hours from now. So there is
so,
that.
Yep. So definitely watch that 12 hours from now. I'll tune in for some of that.
Cool. So I think we might have an interview. I'm not too sure.
I think there will be.
Right, so that's where we're just talking through this commercial.
Sorry about that. But what will be interesting tomorrow is that Zui Wo, who is one of the better players on Celestial, is going to play Gold Series first.
Oh, that's interesting. So how is he going to... Oh, I guess because of the show match?
So yeah.
Have to book it over to the HGS studios. As you can see, our traditional lead up to the to what we normally get out of commercial with, but it looks like we're probably gonna have an interview here, so here we go.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, Notomari is going to play both the Ghost series, and he is listed on that show match, so I don't know how they're going to work that out.
No Tomorrow is a warlock. He's an actual warlock, and he's gonna use magic to be able to do both at the same time.
Yeah, and he is actually on the whole team. Right. On the whole team is No Tomorrow, Valera, Yula, Peggy, and on Alliance team is Teaser, Forever, Gosler, and Chiotu. For this, yeah, I'm excited to play all day Hearthstone, but admittedly, I'm a little bit exhausted in the end, and things are going on in my mind, and I didn't know quite what was going on, but I'm very grateful to Robin, who solved the problem and saved the day for us in the end. Actually, Father was pointing the trophy and said, yeah, I'm the guy who with the knife there. Father actually said, yeah, actually, I'm the person who made the most mistakes, and we'll go home and do some studies and do better tomorrow. Robbie actually said, I didn't actually play that well as I wanted to, but I'm the hard carry here. I'm the Moloch there at the bottom. I mean, followers' mistakes are definitely unforgivable. Which because they are basically results of refusing my advice. Stevie Shaman actually said, yeah, I played okay today. I think that performance was fine. I decided to lose because I wanted to give my teammates some opportunities.
Good guy, Stevie Shaman.
Yeah,
Yeah, and we'll go back. We'll do some review, and we will just do better tomorrow. No, nice our lessons.
I want to see what Rustic has to say, honestly. He's been pouting the entire
yeah.
time.
It wasn't really my fault. my opponent has too, my opponent's draw are too good. I couldn't do anything about it. I mean, Macbeth, you know. And I didn't actually expect Mage Mage coming. I thought it was Freeze Mage or something. And I couldn't really do anything about it.
I'm not sure the Mulligan changes for Face Hunter though.
And actually, Serious Shaman say I will give 0.5 out of 10 for Fall Divers Day. And Rosicky actually said, yeah, we won today because we performed like a team, and we have very healthy discussions during the breaks, and I think we deserve the win.
Very healthy discussions.
About Robin's decision to play single rogue by weapons, he said, well, I mean, that's what happens to him. You know, he sometimes thinks that 10 plus 10 is more than 16 plus 4. And we'll go back and prepare really well and for the final tomorrow. And we have an EDG coming up next.
EDG entrance music, apparently.
就是我们队长走在第一个小部分，我们聊聊现在的心情吧。I'm kind of sad because that to lose. And but we tried really hard.
确实，那其实对今天最后是获得第三名的成绩还满意吗
？But I mean, sometimes in Hearthstone, RNG happens. And nothing we could do too much about it, and we will accept the result. Bishop said, yeah, it's finally over. I'm really glad that we can go out to have some food. Actually, they didn't have supper and they didn't have much much lunch either. Yeah, actually, he said that the problem for us is that we prepared a lot for Tongfu and we didn't have that much time to prepare the second series, and it was done in a bit of rush, changing decks and discussing and also thing. And we have Yilin. Yeah, actually, Yilin said, I don't think Not Tomorrow played too badly in this series, but.
知道没有？知道吧？嗯，知道。Actually,
I gave all my skills to Yilin last night.
那其实作为整个战队的carry，你为什么会想躺赢呢？我觉得你心态就不对啊。心累，carry太多了。就
carry 了半个赛季。No tomorrow, actually, Snowkiss, why did you want? Actually, didn't want to play. You just want your teammate to winning for you. Not to mention that. Well, I'm kind of tired from the bottom of my heart, and sometimes this will happen if you carry too much. I mean, that's a very kind of joking response, not really serious. Lotomaro said, yeah, I was wrong to think that actually 2 amps is better than 4 amps in Warlock Mirror.
好,摇摆哥读哪一口,我们也恭喜一下YM。
And Notomaro said, yeah, I mean, YM is really on their form, and I think they will win the whole thing, and that's here we are.
Alright, thank you very much, Shrink, and really crazy finals, honestly, that's gonna happen tomorrow. As we see the rest of the studio there and the players, or the people who decide to stay there until, you know, after midnight, probably gonna have a hard time to get home if they don't have a train, but that's for them to worry about. In any case, that is going to be it for us today. Looking really forward to seeing Yolo Miracle versus Celestial tomorrow. And in my opinion, I mean, we're going to talk about this tomorrow as well, but just the individual collection of players at the very least, I feel like these are definitely the two best teams in the league. So it's going to be awesome. And any last words, guys?
I'm looking forward to it. I think this is a match that we've been looking forward to for some time now. I think I agree they're the best two teams. Not just the best players, but also the best teams that have worked as teams together in the league. So, and I'm really looking forward to see what happens.
Yep. So, just to recap, I mean, also, make sure you follow us on Twitter. Make sure you follow us, HSCN, as well on Twitter. And follow this channel. Follow, I mean, if you want to also follow us on Twitch, that'd be awesome as well. But that will allow you to gain the information as far as how this is going to work out. As far as we know right now, I am casting Gold Series in 12 hours. And the actual finals is going to be 20 hours on this channel. And there could be show match. We'll see if someone, we decide to cast that, which will be a few hours before 20 hours from now. So that, I guess that would be 17 hours from now. If you're interested in that, make sure you tune in. And I think I'm forgetting to say something.
No, I think we just...
It's going to be on my YouTube. Everything's going to be on my YouTube, so go there too. Okay. Anyway, thanks guys for watching, and good night.
Night.
Good night.